All the world's a stage. Is it any wonder that that's one of William Shakespeare's most memorable lines? Even people who could care less about poetry. And much like Da Vinci and the others, is it any wonder that there seems to be some sort of cryptic, mystic, embedded meaning when he talks about this is the seven ages of man in the same act as he opens with the words, all the world's a stage. Well, as they say, a picture is worth a thousand words. So if you've seen these, I'd like you to kind of bring back to memory these two motion pictures. They convey huge concepts that I don't have time to revisit right now, but you should have them in your consciousness because they're predictive programming, so they're supposed to be there. The first one is The Truman Show, and the second one is They Live. So you might want to keep these glasses handy because I want to take a second look at a few things. And some of it is, it's going to be hard to believe. But as we go through some of this stuff, just kind of keep that in mind. The Truman Show meets They Live. And hopefully, once we look at it this way, you'll be able to make a whole bunch of connections that I'm not even going to mention in this video. And again, I know this is a long video, but please bear with me and please hang around till the end because this is not a video about just transgenderism. This trans agenda is far more than sex. So please hang around and wade through the transgender portion to get to the other stuff. I'm going to talk about MK Ultra, and I'm going to talk about the Montauk Project, and I'm going to talk about the alien agenda. Yes, I will start out with the transgenderism among the aristocracy throughout all ages of history and trace it back to the mystery schools and all of that. And all through Hitler's SS brown shirts, you know, which ties into the Ashkenazi Jews that I was talking about in the last video. I'll even be talking about SRA and all sorts of things. So please be patient and be willing to invest a little bit of time. You know, we gave the public indoctrination system, public education, at least minimum 12 years of our life. And a lot of us, another 4 years after that in the universities, or 6 years or 8 years. And before we woke up, every time we sat down to a Hollywood movie, we'd give them 2 hours of our life for them to indoctrinate us. We should at least have the same attention span for the truth as we had for the lies. And I get a ton of comments, you need to make your videos shorter, videos shorter. And honestly, that's the exact opposite of what God has called me to do. That's a huge problem in the truth community is soundbite, soundbite, soundbites. So we have this massive pile of puzzle pieces of truth just kind of thrown out in a big chaotic pile. And you know, you'll see people, they'll put a couple of pieces of the puzzle together here and there, and oh, here's a big chunk of it where people took the time and did a 28-minute video and put some together. But God has specifically called me for unity in the body of Christ. That's a huge part of my calling. It has been. I wrote about it in my book 15 years ago. I know what I'm supposed to do. So please, patience is a virtue. I have to take all of these little pieces of the truth. And you know, in my videos, most of this stuff, most of the clips I use is all stuff that people have seen a million times before. But it's when you bring it together and start putting those pieces together so we can see the big picture, the big picture. And to do that, it takes a little bit of time. I'm not just going to throw one little sound bite out there for sensationalism. I want to take the time to put the puzzle together. Please walk with me through this. If you have to put it on your watch list and pause it and watch it in segments, then whatever you have to do, you know, we TiVo'd shows for the world. You can do that here. But I think if a video goes over 12 minutes, you know, and maybe it's 2 hours, I think that's a small investment of your life compared to the 12 years you gave to the re-education camps where they taught you their narrative. Okay, but I want to start by jumping back to Shakespeare. You know, this is the precursor to Hollywood. During the plays of that era, all of the female roles were played by male actors.
I always feel silly. I guess men do of going, as they say, in drag, but the history of theater shows that years ago in Elizabethan times, I guess, all of the women's roles were played by men.
And these males were groomed for this. Now, obviously, these are modern pictures, but I'm going to get to some actual old pictures here pretty soon. But this troupe or this circle of actors slash actresses that traveled around doing these plays, they were trained for this and specialized in this. Their voices were trained, all of it, to pretend to be women. And I know we've all been taught that it was just because of misogyny, right? It's just because everything was patriarchal and all of this type of thing. But that's not the case. It's because this is how that ruling class, the aristocracy, this is how they lived. From ancient times, this is how they lived. And this is common knowledge. This isn't conspiracy theory at all. This is from their own books. And you can see right here in the table of contents, androgyny is the guiding principle of the new age. This is what they're doing. They themselves, in their own writings, they talk about their ancient pagan gods and the androgyny. I mean, I don't have to show a picture of the Baphomet again. We all know about the androgyny of the Baphomet. Not only is it a trans species, that it's a goat-headed, pan-type Nephilim creature, but that it has the female breasts and the male phallus, but then, all of these other pagan gods from ancient history, where they believe, this is what they believe, that you're somehow ascended, you're somehow better than and above if you embrace, all of this bisexuality and transgender and all of that. This is all part of their occult religion. It's not a coincidence that all of these celebrities are coming out and coining this phrase pansexual, like Miley Cyrus. Oh, a new frontier, right? As they're indoctrinating their followers, all going all the way back to Disney, the people that they have gathered to follow them, and then they lead them into the new frontier, pansexual. Because pan is just another name for the Baphomet. Pan is another name for Hasatan, a satyr, Satan. So they're open about it. They're open about training humans to be pansexuals, like Pan. And they're not just using celebrities that we've all known and trusted since childhood to push pansexuality. They've raised up an entire crop of models now for fashion. And the new trendy thing, they create the trends. We're the followers, they're the puppeteers. They create the trends, and the trend they are pushing now, which unfortunately has caught up a lot of our naive young people, is the androgyny from their cult practices. So you see, there's tons of new models like this. It's endless. And here's Ruby Rose. They make no secret of it. For ultimate in androgynous inspiration. Inspiration means to be indwelled with a spirit. Inspiration, inspired to do something, means you're anointed to do something. And you can see the Ouroboros around his neck. I know, again, they say she was born a female, but I think that's up for debate. But the fact remains that they are raising these people up by the multitudes in every profession, and they're placing them in key roles. In the most popular TV series, like they just placed her in Orange to Black to get more exposure, then all of the fashion trends in the music industry, they're placing them everywhere. This is sex cult propaganda, open sex cult propaganda. I mean, they say it openly. She schools us on gender fluidity. She's the teacher. This is a figurehead for the cult. She is sent to teach us. He is sent to teach us. Pansexuality. And who is the god Pan? The goat-headed god Pan? It's the Baphomet. Pansexuality. And break free. That's one of the propaganda pieces to teach people to transition. And if you think it doesn't work, let's look at some of the comments on this video. Ruby helped me come out as pansexual and gender fluid. Her positivity is such an amazing vibe that I cherish. And they're all like, same, same, bisexual, same, samey. So here, right here's the evidence that propaganda works. They know how to indoctrinate people into a cult. They know how to use MKUltra on the masses. Pansexual, right there. Pansexual. And they've been leading humans down this path since ancient times. That's where we get the term hermaphrodite. It comes from Hermes. These are ancient fallen angels, pagan gods. Hermes and Aphrodite together created an offspring called Hermaphroditus, from where we get the term hermaphrodite. According to the ancient records, they began genetically engineering this thousands and thousands of years ago. And again, another evidence that these records are not mythology, because we still see that trait in a small remnant percentage of humans. It's in the human gene pool. It's very rare, but there are still occasionally hermaphrodites born, which is what I've shown zillions of examples of in my videos. That although it's hard for us to believe because we've been brainwashed into this false paradigm, this mainstream narrative in quote unquote public education, but these entities are real. And when it says that they contaminated the human gene pool, we see that medically it's provable. Like in my five shocking things you didn't know were in the Bible video, I point out like here's the records that giants existed back then. And then we still see a remnant of that showing up in the human gene pool today. We call it acromegaly now, giantism. Then we see records in the Bible where it talks about this race of Gittites from Gath who had 24 fingers and toes, six on each hand and six on each foot. And we still see that trait show up in the human gene pool. Again, very rare, but it does pop up. That's Halle Berry's foot. They say that Halle Berry, Oprah Winfrey, the pitcher Alfonseco, lots of people have six fingers and six toes. And now we call it polydactyl. And then the Bible records that Esau was born, came out completely covered in red hair, that he was a hair-covered man. And it gives detailed examples about covering his brother's arms and neck in goat hair, in goat skin, so he felt hairy. So, I mean, it was talking about a fur-covered, a hair-covered man, Esau, the descendants of Esau. And throughout history, we've seen in the human gene pool, again, it's very rare. And, we talk about the Nephilim tribes of Sasquatch and things like that, but I'm talking in the human gene pool, we still see that intermixing pop up. And these are pictures from medical journals. This is a genetic trait passed down family bloodlines. And today we call it hypertrichosis. But the point is, all of these beings recorded in ancient times are not mythology. We have the evidence, scientific evidence. We're the ones who are kept in the dark about everything, but they know about Hermes and about Aphrodite and about Hermaphroditus. And they worship pansexual gods. And you can follow it down the lines throughout all of history. So then you go into the Roman Empire, and they were very much into all sorts of sexual perversion, that lots of them were into pedophilia and pederasty, as well as homosexuality. Most of the emperors had young boys, you know what I'm saying, in their courts. And we see that follow down the Roman lines as well into the Roman Catholic Church. I mean, this is an article from last summer. This just happened last summer, where the police neighbors complained about this apartment and the police raided it, and there was a giant drug-fueled a homosexual orgy in there amongst the Catholic hierarchy. This is real. There's a strain of dynasties that say they descended from the ancestral gods, and that's why they were the kings and queens and royal families and all of that type of thing. And that exactly matches the Bible story of the fallen angels. Whether it's Aleister Crowley saying that he is channeling these demons, openly saying it and writing about it, or whether it's these new books they're putting out that they're saying, oh, we have formed our new world religion on these ancestral pagan gods from ancient times, with the androgyny and all of that. But it's all the same thing. The Illuminati families are under the control of these demons. And I know I continue to reiterate that in all of the videos, but that's because I see this problem in a lot of the truther community. They're down here, Rothschilds, 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 talking about these people when the real controllers are up here. This is a spiritual battle. It's hidden right in plain sight. They're open about it. So I know this is difficult, but please just take a look at some of these queens. I mean, there's a reason why that phrase was coined. They're laughing at us, drag queens. So anyway, just take a look at some of the aristocracy throughout world history with new eyes. Here's Queen Maud of Norway. I'll just show them to you. A picture is worth a thousand words if you have eyes to see. And this is Princess Stephanie of Monaco. But let's take a look at a few other pictures of Princess Stephanie. Again, like they taunt us, they mock us, and it's been right in front of our eyes the whole time, hidden in plain sight, like everything else I've discussed on my website, hidden in plain sight. Okay, you might want to put these glasses on because this one's going to hurt a little. Let's go back and take a look at some pictures from her childhood before all of the makeup and the fancy gown. And I know it's heartbreaking when they market themselves to us as stars and the people's princess and all of these types of things. I know this is really difficult. This is a tough red pill to swallow. But please just look at some of these images of who we know as Princess Diana. And there's more. There is a conspiracy theory out there that says the death of Princess Diana was just the death of a character. The character she was playing, he or she's playing as Princess Diana, and now she has assumed this character of David Furnish, who is Elton John's homosexual partner. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that I subscribe to this theory at all. but I do want to present this topic because there's a reason. There's a reason why people are saying these things. People are starting to wake up and be conscious of their surroundings. And they're like, wait a second. And they're noticing these things. And they're trying to make sense of it. And maybe their theory isn't correct, but there is a kernel of truth in all of these theories. There is a reason why people are saying, hey, something weird's going on here. Now, again, most of the theories out there are saying that these are the same people because when they overlay the pictures, they match up perfectly. Their smile, the lazy eye on one side, everything matches up perfectly. But another possibility to consider is that we do see these type of breakdowns with these people who have been generationally transitioned as young children. At some point, they have a breakdown. We see it all of the time. And they want to go back. They want to transition back to their actual sex. So you'll see something like Britney Spears shaving all of her hair off and they got to secret her away into some sort of institution and handle it. You'll see, you know, Diana turning back into David. You'll see Chaz Bono, who was raised as a girl, but most probably what was a boy.
Ladies and gentlemen, from Television City in Hollywood, the Chastity Bono Show. Back from there, I'll introduce you, and you can come out and.
Girls are quicker at ABC.
Our girls are hipper at 1, 2, 3s. Girls are smarter than your computer, much more accurate,
much more cuter.
Girl, times are changing and we're right with them. We're in harmony.
We got rhythm.
Roles are changing and girls are switching. Leave the diapers.
Leave the kitchen.
When all said and when all is done, we're brighter than anyone.
You got false eyelashes.
False eyelashes. Shall we go on with this? Everything else is real.
Because I'm a woman. W-O-M-A-N. I'll say it again.
So something like Chaz Bono would be presented to us for the transgender agenda, that they're like, oh, look, she's transitioning into a male. When if you look into it from the beginning, it seems that she came up through one of these families and that Chaz was originally a boy and was breaking down and wanted to go back. And I'll go into the statistics on that later on, suicide rates and transitioning back and all of that. Okay, but let's jump back Diana David for a minute. I know this seems completely impossible, but there are lots of other suspicious things, anomalies surrounding this that predate Princess Diana's death. For example, here's a clip of President Reagan slipping up and calling her Princess David. It's only like a 10-second clip, but I grabbed it from Jungle Surfer TV. He does a lot of stuff on this. As always, all of the credits and all of the links will be below in the description box.
We have been able to have this affair with Princess David. Have this affair with Princess David, Princess Diane.
And they do slip up from time to time. You will see them calling these people by their male names. Here's Obama calling Michelle Michael.
Distinguished guests, Michael and I also want to acknowledge your son Jack, who's deployed today.
Is anything scaring?
You know, when my Michelle's mad, I get worried. when Michelle's mad.
I mean, there's no doubt that the insiders in this ruling class, in these Illuminati families, of course, they all know what's going on. They are it. So we see that all the time, like the Bruce Jenner thing in Family Guy, long before everybody else knew about Caitlyn and all of that. The same thing with the Kevin Spacey scandal before he came out as a homosexual and all these allegations about pedophilia and pederasty. You know, there was in Family Guy, they know, the people who run in these circles, they know all about it. We're the ones who are kept in the dark. But like the Bible said, all things will come to light. As Jesus Christ approaches, everything that is hidden will come to light. And it is. We're doing it right now.
And do you think that the country will see the United States will see the first gay president or the first
well,
woman
we already
president?
have it with Obama, so let's just calm down.
Got it.
You know Michelle is a trans.
I'm sorry, she's a what?
A transgender. We all know.
Oh my gosh.
But there's a deeper issue that has really nothing to do with sex here. There's definitely something strange going on that you would have so many people that look so exactly the same, whether the whole world is a stage and they really are just playing characters in all of this, or whether they are indeed different people of that. It's still really interesting because why are we seeing so many humans in these ruling classes? You know, this isn't like some guy off the street that looks like Diana. This is one of the ruling class artists, Elton John's boy toy. And there are lots of other examples that we know they're not the same person, but genetically, they look exactly like the same person. And always again in this celebrity status. Like, here's one example of the facial overlays with Justin Bieber and Miley Cyrus. Very genetically similar. John Podesta, again, politician for Hillary Clinton. And then Chester Bennington on the stage as a musician. So, I mean, it doesn't matter if they're on the political stage, if they're the pop stars, if they're the movie stars, if they're the royalty. There's something going on genetically here. It's clear. This is probably one of the stranger ones if you believe the whole world is a stage and this is all theater. Have you seen the overlays of Justin Kavanaugh and his accuser? That's some weird stuff. And then I covered this one in the last couple of videos and a lot more examples like this. But yeah, where we see players on the political world stage from history. And then we see these genetic lookalikes on the world stage again now. And people have been noticing these anomalies and doppelgangers and stuff for quite a while, but they couldn't make sense of them because we didn't have the whole big picture. So, for example, another one people would say, oh, Princess Diana is really Ondine Rothschild, or Ondine, I'm not sure how you pronounce her name. But this is her. This is the Rothschild. Now, I don't think that, but clearly she is from the same gene pool. I mean, there is no doubt that Princess Diana, who we call Princess Diana, is a Rothschild. She's not a Spencer. She's a Rothschild. Now, I don't know if this is, if David, Ondine, and Diana are three different genetic. You know, genetic offspring, however they do that in vitro, test tube babies, I don't know. But clearly, Diana is a Rothschild. And I'm no transvestigator. I don't have time for that, really. But in my opinion, I think Ondine Rothschild is also trans. That this is a man. She looks a lot like Diana there, that hairstyle. But if you look through the high society pictures and stuff, you can see that as she has aged, the masculine features come out because the cartilage continues to grow. And plus, they have to lay off of the hormone shots and stuff the older they get because of the hormone damage. So when they're young and their skin is supple and everything, it's really hard to tell the difference. But if you watch them age, it completely comes out. And that's why we see all these atrocities of plastic surgery disasters amongst the elite. and especially the Hollywood actresses as they grow old, because they have to, once they can't take those hormone shots without it killing their organs, then they have to do all of these surgeries to compensate, and it's just a disaster. And they still end up where they can't hide it. The Princess of Sweden is a perfect example of that, because when she was a young man, you know, she could pull it off, sort of. But as she aged, I mean, look at this. Come on. Come on, you guys. And until everything started coming to light, we just couldn't make sense of it. We're just like, whoa, they didn't age well. But this is why. Now, I know lots of people, like they commented on my other videos when I've talked about this amongst the celebrities, they'll say, oh, it's just a doppelganger. Well, I don't doubt that, but keep in mind where doppelganger came from. The word doppelganger is a German word that means evil twin or twin stranger. And it comes from stories dating back, you know, to the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s, where these upper class people reported mysteriously seeing their evil twins. And it's no coincidence that we discovered, when we busted up the Axis of Evil and we went into Germany, and it was found that Joseph Mengele of the German Nazi regime was conducting all of this experimentation on twinning. Obsessed with twinning. The notorious Nazi doctor Joseph Mengele, who had conducted twin quote-unquote studies in Germany and experiments with twins in Auschwitz, is known to have fled to South America. That's what we talked about in the last couple of videos, as the Allies were closing in on the Nazi German regime. An Argentine historian suggested that Mengele conducted experiments on women in that area also. So this continued. It continued even after we found out what they were doing in the camps, this mad scientist research. So keep that in mind as we go forward here. And also keep in mind that the term doppelganger was coined long before this modern iteration that we call the Nazi regime, or the Third Reich. We all know they weren't just a political regime, but they were highly occult. And if you go back through all of their occult literature, you see that they were going all over to other nations, collecting these artifacts and manuscripts, and they were going to Tibet and meeting with Tibetan monks, and they were going into these caverns, meeting with these quote-unquote masters. And we all know who lives underground. Long before the Nazi thing, there was the ancient aliens. They've always been around. Going back, you know, the Bible calls them the Nephilim. They're the ones who made all of these hybrid races, the monsters of ancient mythology. We talk a lot about the humanoid descendants of those, the Gentile races, the Nephilim races. But the Book of Enoch records clearly that they also took 200 of the animal species and made genetic hybrids of them. And that's, you know, the Sphinx, that's all the stuff that we see in all of the ancient record, the archaeological record, that again is hidden in plain sight. It's right in front of our eyes, but they're like, oh, just don't pay attention to that. It's not real. I know they're archaeological finds and it's science, but we don't count that. That's just mythology. Ignore it. But if you don't ignore it, it all matches up. These ancient Nephilim races, these interdimensional hybrids, they have been doing genetic experiments in this world for a long time. Still to this day, alien abductees report that they're harvesting DNA, they're harvesting fetuses, they're doing these hybrid programs. It's all what the alien abductees say, because the aliens are the demon spawn. They're the armies of Antichrist. And then you see it with the Nazis in World War II, all these reports that they were working with these advanced races and exchanging technology and all of that. And then what do you see in the Nazi camps? Yes, you see their studies in genetics and the master race and the twinning and all of the same demonic things that have been going on throughout all of history. It's just different iterations of the same exact agenda. And now the cabal has completely taken over every nation. It's endgame time. And we have these deep underground military bases where they brought all of these German scientists over to the United States in Project Paperclip, so that we could glean their technology, but all we did was facilitate their infiltration of our nation. So all of these Nazis went right according to the cabal's plan, went right into all of our scientific fields and took them over. And now essentially we're all under the control of Nazis. Look at the professors in the universities. They're all socialists. They're all teaching Antichrist. Look at NASA. That was established all by Nazis, Wernher von Braun. And like I talked about in the last video with the Ashkenazi Jews, that's where we get the word Nazi. Who do we see running Hollywood, right? The Ashkenazi Jews. So, I mean, they've got us coming and going. But it's all one underlying shadow government or cabal. And I know we talk a lot about the deep state, but this is deeper, deeper than the deep state. This thing is huge. And that cabal consists of more than just humans. The kings of the earth absolutely are in a peace treaty with these Nephilim demon spawn and their ruler, Satan, and they are the armies of Antichrist. So if you're still way down on the pyramid thinking the peace treaty is like a couple of politicians and like a politician like George Bush or somebody's going to step up and go, hey, by the way, I'm God, and that's going to deceive everybody, you're looking in the wrong place. You need to look up, because that peace treaty between the kings of the earth and the Antichrist, That's this Nazi UFO connection. That's the kings and queens that I've been showing in the video. That's the kings of the earth. The kings of the earth aren't these politician figureheads that they're showing us on the news. No. The kings of the earth are the literal kings and queens of these Illuminati bloodlines. And again, I don't necessarily mean the kings and queens that we are shown on the news. Those are the tip of the iceberg. The kings and queens I'm talking about, you will never see on a news broadcast. You have probably never heard their names. You can rest assured, if you see it on television or in the news media or magazines or any of that, it's a figurehead. That's part of the theater that they show us. The real string pullers, the people who really consider themselves the rulers of humanity, they're way in the shadows. They are the ones who are already in a peace treaty. We're not waiting for anything. You're watching a magic show. You're watching theater on the news. That's an illusion that they are putting on to distract you. The peace treaty has already happened. They are already, these men in black, this shadow government, they are already in a treaty with these alien demon spawn races in the deep underground military bases, the Dumbs. It's already happened. They're in the peace treaty. The human counterparts, they think they're really somebody. You know, oh gosh, look at them. They've got all this power. They've been given all this power and wealth. But they've been duped too, because demons hate humans. They want to destroy humans and trap their souls in hell. So that's what we're waiting for, is for the peace treaty to be broken. So while they've helped these demons enslave mankind through these systems, these human systems, the establishment, in the end, they've been deceived by the demons too, because they're not going to be ruling nothing. They're going to be exterminated. The end game of the demons is the extinction of the human race. That's how they trap souls, when there are no more incarnations. So all of you people out there that think, oh, well, reincarnation and I got another chance and I'm going to balance my karma. Hey, you better go to Jesus Christ and have him pay your karmic debt right now, because a time is coming when this peace treaty is going to be broken and there is going to be UFO disclosure. And they're not going to be your buddies. They're coming for the extinction of the human race. Kill, steal, and destroy. That's what demons do. And when that day comes, you better be ready to be, for Jesus to take you out of this dimension, out of this world, because God is holy and he has granted free will to all. Satan will get the desires of his heart. He will get a world and a kingdom. He will get hell. And those souls who have willingly served him, who willingly want to stay in that world, who have chosen that of their own free will, they will spend eternity in hell after that, after the extinction. Those souls will remain in that frequency range forever. But he has given us free will to say, no, we will not serve this kingdom. We do not want to stay in this kingdom. We're not putting our trust in this kingdom. We want to go up. We want to go up in frequency to the higher realms, to the heavenly realms. That's where we are going to spend eternity. And you have free will, but you have to do it of your own free will. God is not a spiritual rapist. He's not an evil spirit who is going to take you against your will. God is holy. So you have to invite him into your life and your body and your soul of your own free will. You have to surrender to him and agree to serve him of your own free will. He's not going to take you against your will, even though he loves you. He is holy. That's why you have to ask him into your life, ask him into your heart. All of these things you say, these aren't just like hippy-dippy religious terms. No, you need to do that. If you have not done that, please go down in the description box and click on that link that says Get Saved, and there will be some help there to walk you through, and a prayer. If you need help, you don't need some religious prayer. You just need to ask him of your own free will. You just need to surrender your life to him of your own free will. It's that easy. It really is that easy. But unfortunately, most people won't. They don't. They use their free will to serve the world, to serve these guys. That's why this whole transgender thing is, oh, it's so hipster. And those who willingly serve these people who are running the world and follow them will follow them right into hell for eternity. So this is no small deal. This is why we fight. Day and night, we fight to reason with them. This is endgame. We're at the end of it. They haven't created for us these inanimate objects, these inanimate idols of the gods anymore, worship the gods. No, we're worshiping the stars, just like ancient Egypt, worshiping the stars. Now they're making for us these idols, walking, talking idols. And they even tell us right there to our face, they're laughing at us. Here's your American idol. You guys want another idol to worship and your star worship? Here's another idol we made for you. Here, you can help make this one. You can vote. Help make your own idol with your own hands. And the sleeping, zombie, subservient slaves who worship these celebrities, these stars, these idols, they can't get enough. They're like, I want to dress like you. I want to act like you. I want to be like you. I want to talk like you. I'm going to get tattoos like you. I'm going to be transgender like you. I'm just going to worship you and emulate you, which is the opposite of what the Bible says to do. It says, do not worship idols. And it says to emulate Jesus Christ. Romans 12:2. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. And that is worship. When you offer your body up to the service of any spirit, that's your worship. You've made your choice. You've given them all. So if you're mimicking these American idols, these celebrities, and that's your worship. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, on account of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. So I know it's a hard thing to hear, and it's a hard thing to say, but it's the truth. You are worshiping demons if you have given your body a living sacrifice, your life in service to these ways of the world. It's really very simple. It's not complicated. And what does that mean to be transformed? 2 Corinthians 3:17 and 18. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we, who with unveiled faces, like a bride who's removed her veil, the veil's been removed from our eyes, we can see. And we, who with unveiled faces all reflect the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into His image with intensifying glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Holy Spirit. So whose image are you being transformed into? The image of the world? You organized religions, you quote-unquote churches who are embracing the world and being conformed to the image of the world and putting pride flags up? Pride? Have you read the Bible that pride is the sin that brought Lucifer down? The big one, pride, and you're going to put a pride flag up and be conformed to the image of the world and be conformed to the image of Satan? Whose image are you being conformed to? Are you going to change your body? Are you going to mutilate your body? Are you going to cover it in tattoos and get your genitalia cut off and other genitalia sewed on? And are you going to self-mutilate all to be conformed to the image of the cabal? Or are you going to be transformed into the image of Christ? You have free will. It's your choice. So don't blame God when you end up getting exactly what you wanted. God doesn't send anybody to hell. People choose of their own free will who they worship and who they follow. Are you going to follow Jesus Christ to heaven, or are you going to follow this cabal to hell? And when I say they are making idols for us, I'm not just talking about they're making their careers, you know, lifting them up in the public eye. I'm talking about making idols for us, walking, talking idols for us. Walking, talking bodies that embody spirits. And I know this type of stuff is really considered fringy, but I want to show you that some scientific information, actual scientific medical information about what they're working on with synthetics, clips of these scientists in their own words explaining how they have been working on making synthetics. But I'm going to take my time and lay it out and start with the down-to-earth stuff, because when people see this stuff, it's just parody to them. You can't explain this in 9 minutes and expect the masses to believe this type of thing. So in this video, I'm just going to climb the stairs one at a time, and I'm going to try and lay it out in a logical way so that people can see that this is not science fiction. And because the devil is in the details, I think a lot of people have overlooked astounding links. Lots of people do research into the Vril Society and into world history and even into the alien agenda and even into cloning and different things like that. But if you really pay attention to the details of some of these whistleblower testimonies coming from the Montauk Project, coming from the super soldiers, coming from the My Labs reporting these cloning centers and stuff, there's some really interesting details that people overlook in their testimonies that when you bring all of it together, it's really shocking. It's really hard to believe that something like the androgynes or the transgender agenda would play such a major role in this cabal, but it does. Here's just one of a zillion books that documents how this movement has gone through the ruling class all the way up from back at the mystery schools. Actually, this book, The Pink Swastika, Homosexuality and the Nazi Party, it deals with basically from the World War I, from the early 1900s, World War I through World War II and onward. And I like this book because he cites, it's so well backed up by evidence. This is not a theory at all. This is backed up by at least 200 sources of primary documents. And again, I know that they've rewritten history and twisted stuff around so we can't understand it. So you've probably heard, well, what? They rounded up homosexuals and threw them in the camps, didn't they? No, what happened was there were two factions. There were people doing legitimate research, medical research and psychology on genuine homosexuals, effeminate males. And leading up in the roaring 20s and everything, leading up to World War II, in Germany, there was a culture war similar to what is going on right now in our country, in the United States. And on the other side was this militant homosexual movement of the ruling class. And they didn't want to be mixed in. They didn't want to be lumped in with the effeminate male, you know, genuine homosexuality sort of research. They believed that this was something for the ruling class, because the homosexuality and the transvestite cross-dressing and all of the things that they practiced were part of sex magic or Satan worship. It was part of this SRA that had come down these family lines in this ruling class. And they spoke openly about it, and they practiced that. So there were literally thousands upon thousands of people in the rank and file Nazi party who were arrested for sex crimes during that era. And they ended up being put through these sort of rehabilitation programs in the institutions in Germany. And this, the doctor, the genuine doctors who were doing research and stuff, had files on all of them. So that was the very first book burning, what we call the book burnings, in Nazi Germany. It was actually them raiding the offices and burning their own criminal records for these sex crimes that they had committed, which was mostly homosexual pedophilia. They were largely pederasts. A pederast is a pedophile who likes older children, like in the tweens and teens. And I know the pink swastika and that kind of makes you chuckle or whatever, but seriously, this is nothing to be juvenile or immature about. This is a horror. These children that are brought up through these families, it's child abuse. The things that these children go through, these MK Ultra SRA programs, it's a crime against humanity, and it has to be stopped. This has to end. This has to come to light. Now's the time for it to come to light. So please view this as we go forward for what it is, which is a horror and a crime against humanity. And please realize, when I get to the part about the celebrities and all of that, and I show who these people are in our modern era, please view this content in a mature and serious manner. And if you don't yet understand who created that, what we call the Nazi Party, who was working on this master race and this ruling class, please go back and watch this video that I uploaded 2 videos ago, not the last one, but the one before. It's called Mysteries of the Age to Come, Antarctica, Firmament, Nibiru, Genetic Engineering, Moses and Jesus. But there's a part in there that is specifically about the Nazi regime. And I know that's an hour and a half long video, so you can jump forward to, this looks like it's around a minute and 11. I don't know, probably starts way before that though. Anyway, you can cut an hour off of it and get there. And this is really important, because we have a lot of anti-Semitism, and people don't realize that where we get the term Nazi from, these Ashkenazi Jews, they're not Jews at all. The Bible, and in this, I'll lay it all out for you. I can't revisit it right now. These videos are too long as it is. But I lay it all out through here with the Bible verses and everything. And I talk about, there's a reason why we see these Jews wearing yarmulkes. And we also see the leadership of the Vatican wearing yarmulkes, because these are all these Ashkenazi Jews. And they come from Germany, the Germanic Goths. That's why we see Gothic cathedrals with all of these monsters and demons and gargoyles and all that. I go through all that. So you can jump forward in this Mysteries of the Age to Come video to about an hour and 10 minutes, and you should hit right in there. And I know I'm always pointing back to the other videos, but I don't bring this stuff up because I'm shamelessly self-promoting. I bring it up because all of my videos tie together, and I can't just sit down and do a 200-hour video. It's like a college course. You can't just skip the whole year and then come in for one class 3 months into it and know what's going on. So I get a ton of questions all the time. Oh, this contradicts this, or you contradicted yourself here. And it's because they don't have any idea what I'm about or what, all of these other videos. So I do my best because it's YouTube. It's not a college course. You can come in on any video. So on every video, I try my best to make it easy to jump back, to the previous videos that might have information tying into what I'm talking about right there. So that people don't get lost when you see something like the clip I'm getting ready to play and it says that Adolf Hitler is a crypto Jew, you're like, what? What? No, he hates Jews, right? He was anti-Semitic. And it's like, no, I can't go back and reteach it all. So that's why I'm always pointing back to my other videos. So of course, we see them assuming their role in the trans agenda. Priests to be banned from calling God he or the Lord. And bid to be gender neutral. So it's just the typical old bait and switch. They've drawn in a ton of followers who call themselves Christians and thought that they were being taught about the holy God. And now that they have all of them following them, boom, they switch it up on them. And they're like, oh, well, we're not going to worship the holy God. We're going to lead you into worshiping this androgynous pagan God, or Pan, the Baphomet. And this isn't just happening in the Catholic Church. They've infiltrated organized religion across the board, as well as public education, which we know is indoctrination by definition, because they don't present both. They ban the Holy Bible and its teachings of what holiness and morality and a civilized society is. And then they make it mandatory to preach their pagan beliefs, which is what we're talking about right here. Church of England tells schools to let children explore gender identity. And, here in America, we don't listen to the Church of England per se, but all of you know through the movements and the political leaders and all of that, that they have done the same thing in our schools. They have made pagan indoctrination mandatory, or are in the process of doing so. Okay, so back to the pink swastika. This was written by Scott Lively and Kevin Abrams. So I just want to play you a quick clip from an interview.
And of course, in opposition to that group, they didn't have a lot of regard for Magnus Hirschfeld's thinking in these areas, was the Adolf Brandt group that thought that homoerotic relations between comrades was characteristic of more of a ruling class or Ubermenschen class, and that was the Brown Shirt, that became the Brown Shirt organization, which was controlled by Ernst Röhm after his return from Bolivia in the late 20s at Hitler's request to take charge of the SA and to make it into a more unified fighting force, or a street level sort of fighting force. In 1933, the first book burning in Germany its purpose was to destroy one of the underlying and more significant purposes of the book burning was to destroy Magnus Hirschfeld's library. He is documented by one of the gynecologists that worked with him at the time as having held some 40,000 files documenting sexual crimes amongst the Nazi rank and file, which in the German courts, people who were tried for these types of crimes under Section 175 were sent to Magnus Hirschfeld's Institute for assessment and so forth. And
Kevin, let me ask you a question. How does the fact that all these Nazis were homosexuals translate into World War II?
Well, they were primarily the dominant factor in bringing the Nazi Party to power. Ernst Röhm, any rank above the rank of any person above the rank of sergeant in Ernst Röhm's Brown Shirt organization had to be of that persuasion, and that came. Ernst Röhm's Brown Shirts came out of the Rossbach organization, which was dominated by Gerhard Rossbach, which was one of the Freebooter movements or Freikorps movements that came out of World War One.
Okay, did you catch that? He said that anybody above the rank of sergeant had to be of that persuasion. That's how they came to power.
Well, they were primarily the dominant factor in bringing the Nazi Party to power. Any rank above the rank of any person above the rank of sergeant in Ernst Röhm's Brown Shirt organization had to be of that persuasion.
So it's no coincidence that we see the same thing in our military-industrial complex, in the corporations at the tops, the CEOs of these corporations. I'm going to show you more than just this picture, and you judge for yourself. But it's not just Hollywood actors. And you know, that's a theory. A lot of the people who do the transvestigations, they have settled it in their mind that there are no A-list actors that are not of the persuasion. There just aren't. Even going all the way down to the theater levels, you know, Broadway and stuff, they say it's run by the gay mafia, that you have to come around to their way of thinking. And we see that a lot with people who rise up in the industry and weren't transitioned as children. Then later, after they get famous, all of a sudden it's like some sort of rite of initiation or something. Like, here's the Wachowski brothers. Now they're the Wachowski sisters. They were men. They're the ones who did the Matrix trilogy, the Matrix. And they were men when they did that. But then after they got famous, look, changed their name to Lana and Lily instead of Larry. Here's Larry. This is him with the yarn hair. And it was just sort of out of nowhere. I mean, this brother, he didn't, it's not like they came out together and they're like, hey, we always secretly wanted to be sisters instead of brothers. No, one did it as if part of an initiation. And then the other one followed, you know, quite a while later. Now, presently, I don't subscribe to that every single A-lister in Hollywood, every actor, every actress is transgender and was either changed starting in the womb with shots or starting as very young, you know, infants and toddlers and stuff. But I could be wrong. You know, at this point, nothing would shock me, honestly. But, you know, presently, I don't believe that every A-lister is. But I think it's completely provable and absolutely 100% true that the A-list ranks are full of these people from these families who were born and raised just for this. You know, back in Germany, they didn't have any movies that weren't propaganda. It wasn't like, oh, well, these are just regular movies. And then, you know, oh, but slip in a propaganda, you know, a pro-war, pro-Germany type propaganda piece. No, they had a propaganda minister in their military, Goebbels, and that's what he handled all of it. So, I mean, it wouldn't shock me if it was 100%, but right now I don't believe it's everybody. But it's still definitely worth going to the people who are spearheading this type of research, whether you agree with everything they say or not, but there is a ton of truth in their research. I think Mr. E, they took down his channel, so now he's Transpocalypse Now. Transpocalypse Now, or you can type in like transvestigation, and there's a whole group of followers that have branched off from his lead. And I don't know if there was somebody before him. I'll just type in transvestigation or Transpocalypse Now or Mr. E, you know, and any of these types of topics, and you should be able to find a wealth of knowledge. But anyway, back to what I was talking about, how the structure of the Nazi regime was, the brown shirts, that you had to be of the persuasion to reach the level of sergeant or above. That's a fact. It's like the Freemasons. To get to the 33rd degree, there are secrets, you know, that have to be kept, and the people at that level all know it. So there are levels. And, you know, we've heard all sorts of rumors about Google and, you know, all the heads of these different major, major multi-billion dollar corporations. But here's just a few that I think are obvious. You know, you be the judge. Notice this on the magazine cover. They always do this queen again with the mocking. Queens again. Queen Serena. Queen. On the cover of GQ, a man's magazine, as Man of the Year. Before the massive breast implants and other cosmetic surgery. Okay, back to the CEOs. Now, when I get to the A-list celebrities here in a minute, and I do like Sarah Silverman and some of these who are, you know, they're always wearing the feminism shirts and they're icons for the feminist movement. It's important to know that not just the corporations, but all of these movements are also headed, anybody above the level of sergeant, you guys. When I get into more detailed pictures and anatomy here in a minute, we'll talk about these Adam's apples and stuff. But for now, I just want to run through these and you be the judge. Okay, let's jump into Hollywood for a little bit. Okay, before I go into the ones that we believe are deceiving us, the hidden ones, this hidden hand who are doing this, I just want to show you some pictures of openly transgender male and females that in a 2-minute search on anywhere, on YouTube or on Google, anywhere, you can find multiple articles. These are transgendered males and females who are proud of what they've done and they want to show off, you know, their bodies and stuff. So this is not a conspiracy. These are actual transgender males and females. And I want to show this because I think a lot of people are still expecting this. So when they look at these beautiful women or these very attractive men, they're like, there's no way, because they expect, you know, transgenders to still look like the way they did in the royals and the way they did in old times. But we're well beyond that now. Not only do we have all of this plastic surgery where they can alter jawbones, that, you know, nose jobs, everything that all of the Hollywood elite have, whether they're transgendered or not, they all have nose jobs and boob jobs and all kinds of stuff that they didn't have back when the royal families were doing this. So we have this small window of opportunity to see, before all of the technological advances, to see what was going on. But now it's almost impossible to see, because well beyond plastic surgery, now we have all of the hormone treatments, which actually changes your voice. It changes your muscle mass. It changes your hair growth. You know, to grow a beard, it changes everything. Well, not everything, but, you know. And then even well beyond that, now they are into altering in the petri dish. During the in vitro process, they are altering gender. So we are well beyond this. Now we have a generation of transgenders that are almost indistinguishable. I mean, some of them completely indistinguishable unless you had access to their medical records. So anyway, let's just take a look at some openly transgendered people so you can get an idea of what's going on today. Now, this is a woman that wasn't transitioned in the petri dish. So you can see how much progress they can make without even messing with a person genetically. I mean, this is another woman. And again, this is not anyone who was altered genetically in the petri dish. This is just from the hormones and plastic surgeries and stuff available to common people. And these aren't multimillionaires and billionaires like the celebrities. And they have access to all of this sort of medical stuff. And this is what I was talking about. See, this is just mainstream. This is just mainstream, you know, magazine stuff for transgenders. This is female to male facial surgery, facial masculinization, to make the female face appear more masculine, to be used in addition to testosterone therapy. The forehead can be lengthened, the cheeks and nose augmented, and most importantly, the jaw reshaped and chin recontoured, which is one thing we see a lot in them. They'll get the chin dimple, they'll get implants, you know, jaw implants and all this. I mean, it's hard to believe, but this is for regular people. This isn't just for the celebrities. So these aren't multi-millionaires. This is what's available. This is the world we live in. So this is the woman over here with the beard. The only reason this picture's here, I mean, lots of people theorize about a lot of men in, quote unquote, men in Hollywood. I'm not saying that Ryan Gosling is FTM just because he was a Disney kid and came up through this. I don't know. There's no way for me to know. I don't have access to his medical records, but this picture was just juxtaposed against this one to show you that a female can absolutely present just as well as any of these males in Hollywood. So please move forward with us as we discuss this topic and don't discount it just by looks alone and say, there's no way. Well, there is a way. And these are the Hegiras in India. And you can see they look like beautiful women. I mean, this one over here didn't turn out so great, but you know, these, a lot of them look gorgeous, like beautiful women, but these are Hegiras. These are men who dress like women and impersonate women. They cross-dress and do all of this stuff as a worship to one of their gods. And as always, that precisely matches the historical records recorded in the Holy Scriptures, the Holy Bible, in the Old Testament, when it talks about the old world that was wiped out, is in 1 Kings and in Deuteronomy. It talks about these, they were the temple prostitutes, people who committed sodomy and dressed, cross-dressed, transvestites. Said they wore, the men wore women's clothes and pretended to be women, and they did all of this sexual perversion. You guys have read the Old Testament. It always talks about this, and they were sodomites. So in 1 Kings it says, and there were also sodomites in the land, and they did according to all the abominations of the nations which the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. And in Deuteronomy it says, the women shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither a man shall put on a woman's garment, for all that do so are an abomination unto the Lord thy God. So, you know, this is where we get all of this simple-minded religious stuff. And I understand why they didn't completely understand what these verses meant, because this is all just now coming to light. So, you know, a lot of people, they like in the Pentecostal movement, they'll say, oh, well, the women have to all wear skirts, you know, because we don't want them to dress like it. No, this is talking about real, true cross-dressing, transvestites, transgenders, that a man shall not put on a woman's garment and commit sodomy. This was what the pagan gods, the fallen angels, this was worship to them. So this is the Hindu god Shiva doing the transgender and the duality and all of that. So this is like we've talked about for years in all of these videos, that the pagan gods recorded way back in ancient history in the antediluvian world on every single continent are the same interdimensional entities recorded in the Holy Bible as the fallen angels. The pagan gods are the fallen angels. The records match up exactly. And in the Old Testament, or the Old World, the first Earth Age, the antediluvian pre-flood world, God had wiped all of that evil out and started over because of all the contamination of the human gene pool. Said that the thoughts of humans were evil continually. But now we're in the middle of a resurrection of this evil kingdom, where the Nephilim and the Raphaim and the hybrid descendants of them are again the ruling class. In the old world, it said that they enslaved humanity. That's what the book of Exodus is about, and Moses leading the humans out of slavery, out from under the Nephilim Egyptians and all of that. But it's coming back. They're resurrecting that. They want to rule over humans again, and that's what we're in the middle of seeing manifest right now. And that's what all of my videos are about. Just because they're not about transgender doesn't mean that they're not about this transition, this transformation. I talk about it in the technology and science, about how they're going about that through 5G and neural implants and artificial intelligence, how they're beaming these frequencies over us to transform humanity into their own image. DNA, I go into the DNA evidence and how they're using viruses to implant DNA in us. Any and all of my videos pertain to this transformation that we are living in. Even the ones that say Antarctica, if you go in there, I'm talking about these Nephilim races, Nephilim hybrids, trans species. So we have trans species, we have transhumanism technology, we have transgender. all of it is part of the transition, even weather modification. It's all part of the same agenda. They fancy themselves the gods. This is star worship all over again. They can control the weather at the push of a button. They can deny, turn off the rain. They can flood you with rain, weather modification and everything. The neural implants, they want to be able to possess humans, to actually possess human bodies. That's the neural implants, to be able to be linked in biologically into our neural circuits, into the circuits of our brain and our nervous system. And they have the worship of the masses. Look at any rock concert. You won't go into a church and see tens of thousands of people with their hands in the air worshiping, but you sure will see that at these concerts, people worshiping these people.
And movie stars are like gods and goddesses. When one fades, another promptly takes its place, because the human race requires that the pantheon always be filled.
Worship. Literal worship of the stars, worship of the elite ruling class celebrities. And they're so mind controlled that you can't even have a conversation with them about it. If you were to tell them that they're worshiping these entities, they wouldn't get it at all. They'd think you're crazy. They even worship them with their money. They give them all of their money. Why do you think Beyonce has like a $3 million countertop in her kitchen? Because of the slave race. All of these people, either they or their parents, went enslaved away and worked inside the corporate entity to get their chits so that they could bring them and lay them at the feet of these stars in worship. It's their offering. Here's our offering. We went enslaved away in the military industrial complex to get our chits, and we're going to come lay them at your feet in an act of worship. Here, you take them. A lot of them don't even have gas money to get back to work, but they'll take their paychecks and they'll lay them at the feet of a celebrity who has a $3 million countertop in her kitchen, just so that they're granted the right to enter the arena and worship at her feet. You know, it's ludicrous. It's absolutely, it's sad. It's so sad. I don't know how to reason with them. We're out here day and night trying to reason with them and wake them up. But presently, yeah, they're laying their offerings at the feet of the celebrities and they're worshiping them openly. And if you tell them that, they'll tell you you're crazy. Okay, but back to the spirits inside of these idols that they've created for us. And keep in mind that these are corporate entities. So one spirit will be animating or controlling multiple people, thousands of people. Just like we are the body of Christ and we are made up of millions or maybe even billions. I think statistics say 2.8 billion people claim to be Christian. And of course, we know that a lot of people who practice a religion and call themselves Christians aren't actually part of the body of Christ, who are literally animated and controlled by Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. But the point stands that these entities are multi-membered beings. This androgyne entity called Shiva, the goddess Shiva, is the one that the people in India worship with their transgenderism and transvestite culture, which is so odd because Shiva is known as the god of destruction, always depicted covered in snakes or snakes wrapped around her or whatever, god of destruction. And yet for some reason, they still worship this entity and form themselves into the image of the goddess of destruction. So we don't call them Hygieras in the United States, but it's essentially, yeah, transgender. They say they are non-binary. Not that they don't take part in sex, but that they say they're non-binary, you know, which is what they're preaching to us here in the United States now. So anyway, these Hygieras, they say that that sexual energy is the same way with the worship that the Bible describes in all of the pagan temples for the fallen angels, that they worshiped them with all of those sexual perversions, that they opened themselves up to demonic possession and let these entities use their bodies to defile themselves. And that's exactly what the modern day Hygieras say. They say the sexual energy is transformed into sacred powers. So they believe this. It's a type of sex magic. Read their books. They're just pick up a book on all the occult stuff. It's all in there for us to see. We're just in denial because this is a hard thing. Now, I know this is a big red pill to swallow, and I'm sorry to have to give this to you. It's unbelievable, but it's true. I mean, all of these women here are not natural women. These are all men. These are pictures from Miss Tiffany's Universe. It's a Thailand beauty pageant for men who have turned themselves into women. Actually, when you see that group of men from Thailand, it makes our drama queens look masculine. And this is nothing new in Thailand. I remember hearing about this decades ago when I was in the Marine Corps and I was stationed in Japan. And a lot of the guys would take hops over to Thailand if they had like weekend leave and it wasn't long enough to go all the way back to the United States. So they would go to Thailand. And I remember the guys coming back all the time telling these stories. Oh my gosh, she was so beautiful. I thought she was a woman. You know, we were on the beach doing this and her junk fell out of her shorts, down the side of her short shorts. I could not believe it. She totally looked like a beautiful woman and all this, that they had these transvestite prostitutes that would always solicit the men and they were scared to death because they never knew if they were going to be making out with a dude or not. And here they are. This is the Thailand beauty pageant of men. These are all men. So please, I'm only showing this stuff because I want you to understand that I know it's hard to believe that these celebrities and these people that we see and they've presented to us as the beautiful ones, that they could be men. So I just wanted to show you some examples of, you know, these transgenders. And you can't tell a lot of the time. It's just a fact. And I know one of the most common reasons that people experience cognitive dissonance when we're trying to discuss these topics and the world we live in is because they've presented so many of them as pregnant to us. So they say, but they were pregnant. It's impossible. Men can't get pregnant. So I'm not going to go into conspiracy theory here at all. I just want to take a few minutes and show you what the celebrities say in their own words about the inordinate amount of them who are not carrying their own children. They say openly in their articles that, oh, a surrogate carried my baby, or they openly go on the circuit about their in vitro fertilization, admitting that these children were created in a laboratory, not the natural man and woman relations. So this is in their own words. I'm not putting words in anybody's mouth and I'm not making assumptions. I'm just going to show you the inordinate amount of celebrities who openly say their children were created in laboratories and that they did not even carry them in their own bodies. And before I start that list, I just want to show you a picture like this. This is another one of those magazine covers. This is Elon Musk's mother. Take a look at that face if you know what I'm saying. And I wanted to go into Elon Musk's family line and who his grandfather was and his lead in the movement of technocracy long before Elon Musk was ever born. His grandparents were part of this, what they believe, technocracy, that the world would be ruled by the leaders in technology. And I wanted to get into all of that. But I'm just not going to have time in this video. That'll be for another day. But suffice it to say that Elon Musk was created for what he's doing. But my point for right here is she's 63 here. This is obviously not her pregnant belly, although this is a very real cover of a magazine they put out. In the article, it goes on to say, Mrs. Musk went on to reveal to Inside Edition, I'm 63. I'm not going to be pregnant. She admitted to posing nude, but said that the final image was altered. They did have a model who was 9 months pregnant and used her belly and put it on me, she added. So she admitted that that was a photoshopped image. And then, of course, the moon bump is old news that everybody knows. It's companies. There are companies. They produce these. The very fact that there's a market for these is, you know, that it would be worth it. Just supply and demand economically to create a company that produces devices that help women fake pregnancy, that there would be such a demand for that, that they could make money by having a manufacturing plant and a sales department and all. It's just, I mean, that should tell you something. They sell them in packs so that you can fake your pregnancy throughout the whole thing. And you know, you've noticed that when a lot of these celebrities get pregnant, they never have any swelling, they never gain any weight. They're just bone thin, except for the baby bump right there. You know, I don't even know how baby could get out of those hips right there. But anyway, you know, if you're a woman and you've been pregnant, when I was pregnant, oh my gosh, everything swelled. My face swelled, my fingers swelled, my hands swelled, my ankles swelled, everything swelled. My swelling had swelling. You know, and but not celebrities. They're just like bone thin model bodies and just a bump. Not all of them, but you know, that's very common to see that. So there's that. Now let's get on to the list of the stars that I wanted to show you who openly admit that they didn't carry their own children. They had another human carry their children in their bodies for them, which are called gestational surrogates. And now don't forget, obviously, every single person who used a surrogate is telling you that the children were conceived in a laboratory, because obviously they're not conceiving children naturally in their bodies and then removing them and putting them in another human. It's a given that anybody on this list who used a surrogate is admitting that those children were created in the laboratories. Sarah Jessica Parker says that her twins were carried by a surrogate. She did not carry them. And in Vogue magazine, she talks about meeting them for the first time in the hospital room. Nicole Kidman says that her second child with Keith Urban was not carried by them. A surrogate carried that for them. And she also had multiple adoptions. And I will talk about these multiple adoptions, and I will talk about the twinning, like with Sarah Jessica Parker, here in just a minute. Obviously, Neil Patrick Harris and David Burtka's children were grown in a surrogate. And likewise, obviously, Elton John and David Furnish's children were also carried in the womb of another human. Elizabeth Banks says that both of her children were grown and gestated in a surrogate who carried them at different times. These were born in two different years, so she had two different children carried by a gestational surrogate. Juliana and Bill Rancic, their child was carried by another person. Both of Jimmy Fallon's children were not carried by his wife, but were carried by surrogates, again, in different years, not at the same time. So two children, both carried by surrogates, Jimmy Fallon. Tyra Banks did not carry her son in her body. A surrogate carried her son. Dennis Quaid's twins were carried by a surrogate. Angela Bassett did not carry her twins in her body. They were grown in a surrogate. George Lucas of Star Wars, his daughter was carried by a surrogate. Matt and publicist Simon Halls have three sons that were all grown in surrogates. Three of Robert De Niro's children were carried by surrogates. And Lucy Liu had another human carry her child as well. She says, "It just seemed like the right option for me because I was working and didn't know when I was going to be able to stop." And this is the lead singer for the Red Hot Chili Peppers. So this is supermodel Heather Christie supposedly carrying his child. Let's just take a look at some more pictures of them. There she is. And again, with a little less makeup. And again, that is Heather Christie. Just saying. And there again, after she had the baby. But it must be true, right? Because all of the magazine photographers made a point to get pictures of her and broadcast them to us throughout her pregnancy. Also, probably just a coincidence that the lead singer of the Red Hot Chili Peppers was raised by his actor dad, who went by the name Blackie Dammit. probably also just a coincidence that we see this whole doppelganger thing. It's the big running joke, right? How the drummer for the Red Hot Chili Peppers is like the twin of Will Ferrell, Chad Smith and Will Ferrell. Just one of those doppelganger phenomenons, another big coincidence. And here's just a few of the elitists who say they did carry their babies, but those embryos were created in the lab. Chrissy Teigen, Courtney Cox, Brooke Shields, Celine Dion, which, you know, has recently become infamous for her androgynous, what does she call it, gender neutral clothing line for babies that says New World Order, New World, and all that all over the clothing, and has skulls and death cult stuff all over the baby's clothing. I'm not going to grab a clip of that. Most of you have seen it, but if not, here's a zillion videos on it. You can see it says New Order right on the clothing. It has the skulls and everything. The kids in the commercial have the Illuminati eye on their hand. It's really disturbing. The commercial's very disturbing. It's not a children's happy, fun Toys R Us commercial. It's dark. And here's a perfect example of how they're really rubbing our nose in it. They're yucking it up over us. This is a men's fashion show in London. And yeah, they made all the men wear these pregnant bellies. I mean, this is mainstream fashion shows. Talk about externalization of the hierarchy. This is why I say that we need to represent Jesus Christ. They think God is dead. They think they've taken the whole world over and they have normalized all this. We need to show people that Jesus Christ is alive. Put your Jesus t-shirts on and go out in public and let people know we are here, because this is what they're showing our children. And they think this is all that there is. They think this is normal. Anyway, for all the people who think, oh, but I've seen them pregnant. Well, here's the London fashion show. Again, New World Order, New World Baby, the same way with Celine Dion's clothing line. And take a second look at who all of our fashion designers are. You think that's a coincidence? No, these people were created for this. They create the trends, they create the designs, and they broadcast them to us. This is what we're supposed to wear. Oh, if you want to fit in, right? You want to fit in. You don't want to face rejection or be ostracized from society. So you put on what they designed for you. You dress like them. You do your hair like them. You even wear the style of socks that are in style right now. Please, please take a second look at these people with new eyes. Old Don here, Donatella Versace. This is your leader? I just can't believe that people can't see when they look at Donatella Versace. Not only can they not see, but they want to emulate this. Ooh, it's Versace. I'm so trendy. I'm so cool. Really? This is what you want to emulate? This is it? You want to spend thousands and thousands of dollars to dress up in everything she produces? What she creates? We have to realize that these people are creating this stuff and broadcasting it to us so that we are transformed into their image. And the whole time they're convincing these mind-controlled slaves of theirs that they're the edgy, you're trendy. Oh, you are so rebellious because look how you're pushing the boundaries. And it's like they're the most mind-controlled rank-and-file slaves of the mainstream. The whole time they're like, oh, I'm so rebellious, I'm trans. Honey, you aren't rebellious. You can't even think for yourself. You're a carbon copy of the people who designed you. You're doing exactly what the cabal wants you to do. You're wearing exactly what the cabal wants you to do. And now even self-mutilating and cutting off genitalia and all sorts of stuff just to emulate your creators, your puppet masters, these people, the ruling class.
But forget skinny jeans. Fashion designers are now pushing female clothing as the next men's fashion trend. For their recent catwalk show, Undercover had these skeletal soy boys parading around in maxi skirts. This fashion designer is portraying men as pigs and dogs. Not only are we under chemical assault from plastic products and foods that lower testosterone, we're mass unwitting participants in a huge social engineering experiment based around vilifying masculinity and demoralizing men.
And that's the fact of the matter. This absolutely is MK Ultra gone live to the masses. They're no longer pulling humans in one by one and doing this trauma-based mind control on them individually. They're broadcasting it to us, causing great confusion and guilt. You guys know that the SRA victims and the MK Ultra victims who have come forward say this exact thing. They were forced to have these sex magic rituals with other children and confusing their am I attracted to, I had this experience with the same sex experience and living with the guilt and the shame and all of that. And then they throw in the abortion and all of these, this generation, the millennials especially, and even younger children have to carry the trauma and the guilt of abortions, which is exactly what the SRA and MK Ultra victims say, that they were forced to murder babies and things like that. So this is MK Ultra for the masses. I mean, it's the very definition of trauma-based mind control. You dip the children in a sewer of sexual perversion and violence and all of that until they disassociate from their identity. And that's precisely what we see in the trans agenda. They say, don't identify with your body. Don't identify with who you are. Disassociate from your identity. And that's precisely what the SRA and MK Ultra victims say, that they're traumatized to the point that they disassociate or even leave their body because the trauma is so intense. And then these other entities enter them. And then they have these multiples, what they call multiple personality disorder or dissociative identity disorder. But we know that that's spirit possession, that that's what these evil spirits do, that the point of trauma, they take advantage of that and they try to enter your life at the point of trauma, which is precisely what we see in this trans movement. They teach them to disregard science and biology and their own bodies and their own genitalia and everything that is them and associate themselves with this entity inside them. So now we have an entire generation almost of these MK Ultra products who are saying openly, well, I don't identify as who I actually am biologically. I identify as this or I identify as that. And then they bring forth these types of role models to teach these people who are now confused and traumatized and full of these other entities, these multiples, to teach them to yield their bodies to them. Yield your bodies to the spirit possession. It doesn't matter if you were Bruce, if something inside you, if you have a Caitlin inside you, what you do is you yield your body to the possession. You allow that entity to possess you now and you become it. So we see things like this. Oh, well, I was Caitlin inside. So now I'm going to self-mutilate. I'm going to castrate myself. I'm going to do all of these things and I'm going to surrender my body to the service of this thing inside me, which I have been told I must identify as. And for some reason, and it's just so sad because these young, naive, brainwashed, generation of humans, they buy into it, hook, line, and sinker. Absolutely. They say, okay, I will disassociate from my own identity and I'll start going around telling everybody, well, I identify as, you know, whatever. And that's the point also with the non-binary is that they say it should be fluid. So you should let these multiples one at a time, you know, possess. You might be this one day and you might be something else the next day. So they want you to completely open yourself up to essentially be their channel, to be a portal for multiple entities. And where they used to individually do the MK Ultra stuff and make them watch images, how all the whistleblowers said they were made to sit and watch these images and these tapes, this propaganda programming. Now we're so far along in this, they've got the new generations programming themselves. I discussed that at great length in my video, Children of the Beast System. Right there, that's the thumbnail with the iPhone slapped on their face. Like an alien implant. They are literally programming themselves. They're eating it up. They can't get enough. Just programming. Hell, destruction, perversion, nakedness, blood, hell, violence, da da da. Just nonstop. They cannot take their eyes off of it. Trauma, 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 trauma. Do you really think it's a coincidence? Just like the royalty I started this video with, Queen Maud and all of them, all the way through the magazine covers with Queen, this and that. And you think it's a coincidence that Freddie Mercury's band that they put forward as propaganda to the masses, that his band was named Queen? Queen! They've been programming us. And I'm tired of being gaslighted. I mean, they openly gaslight. They tell us to our faces, you are crazy. You need to get back on your meds. I mean, it's beyond gaslighting. They just flat out hate speech against us. It's so weird because we can't say anything. Oh, that might offend them. This video, it might be, even though I'm just showing facts, it might be, oh, it's offensive to them. But what if I'm offended? By them shoving all of this murder down my face, them shoving all this blood and gore and death, all the things of hell, perversion, just nonstop down our throats, broadcast over us continually. What if I'm offended? I am offended. I'm very offended. But the way they see it, we don't have any rights. They can offend us. They can gaslight us and tell us we're crazy. Use those words. You are mentally ill. Gaslight us to the point that they have convinced many people they are crazy and they have lost their faith, especially in the university. It's something like 80% of the Christian children who enter the university come out renouncing their faith. And I'm tired of being told we're reading too much into stuff when we say they are actually Satanists, that there are Satanists among them. I'm not reading anything into anything. They say it out of their own mouths. They put it in their own songs. They sing about it. They write about it. They put it on their album covers. Here's just a few examples. On the Beatles cover, Aleister Crowley. And then he writes songs that say, imagine there's no heaven. Wouldn't that be an amazing world if there was no heaven? They bash the Bible. They say the most vile things about Jesus Christ. They esteem these Satanists like Aleister Crowley.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try.
What kind of Satanist and sexual deviants would defend such a wicked man like Aleister Crowley, who was taking advantage of little children as a pedophile? How heartbreaking that anybody would think to defend those who would be promoting Satanist Aleister Crowley's work. Crowley imagined a world without God wherein a Superman race would rule over humanity and abide by his satanic credo, "Do what thou wilt, shall be the whole of the law." Crowley, using the hawk-headed god Horus as a satanic symbol of the new eon to come, said, "With my hawk's head, I peck out the eyes of Jesus as he hangs upon the cross." Sadly, before he died, Freddie Mercury, well aware of surrendering his soul to Beelzebub, as he put it, stated that he preferred the torments of hell to heaven.
Do you think you're going to get to heaven?
No, I don't want to.
You don't want to?
No, hell is much better. Look at the interesting people that you're going to meet down there.
Interesting pitch. But Christianity is borderline illegal in Northern California. Well, then I suppose you also don't know that potbelly pigs have been wildly unfashionable since 2005. Owning a potbelly pig is frowned upon almost as much as being a Christian. Thank you, gentlemen.
During our sex scene, I felt your dick rubbing into me.
I said, "Mom, I am a rich man.
I'm a tranny.
Where is I?
What? I'm a man."
What would surprise people about Jessica Alba?
Good evening, godless sodomites.
Okay, I'm sorry. I got off on a tangent there, but there is just so much information and so many examples on this particular topic. But I do want to get back to the in vitro fertilization and the breeding program. And as you can see on the screen, Gattaca, yet another example of predictive programming. In the interest of time, I'll skip over the next 50 or 100 examples I was going to give of all these elitists who admit that they had their children were created in vitro in labs. And I'm going to move forward to twinning. Remember earlier in the video when I was talking about where the term doppelganger comes from and that it's a German word and that they started showing up even pre the Nazi era, that it seemed to be something that was coming from the Nephilim races, and we know from alien abductions that they're always harvesting DNA and all of that. Okay, we know that Joseph Mengele, one of the programs that he was working on was twinning. They were intensely consumed with making doubles of people. Now, we know in modern lingo, we would call that cloning. But back then in the 1920s, 1930s, 1940s, it was twinning research. But obviously the Nazis were doing research into genetic cloning all the way back then. And I just want to reiterate that when I say Nazis, I'm not just talking about, Hitler and this small group of people that we know as the Nazis. I'm talking about the Ashkenazi Jews that stretch back thousands of years, that I traced all the way through the Gothic cathedrals and all of that. It's all in the past several videos that I've put up. So I'm talking about the Ashkenazi Jews, which politically were represented by the Nazi Party, and then even after World War II continued on. And for those of you who haven't seen those videos, I also want to reiterate that we cannot be anti-Semitic. We cannot. These are not Jews. This is what the Bible says right here in the book of Revelation. "I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know about the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan." And again in Revelation 3:9, "I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you." So I hate that I have to keep pointing that out, but unfortunately there are tons of people in the Truther movement who are teaching about the Ashkenazi Jews and about the Khazarian Mafia, who also claim to be Jews but are not, and they're leading people astray back into anti-Semitism. So they're leading them right back into that Nazi philosophy. So we have to be clear. These people are, just like it says in the Bible, they're the synagogue of Satan. This is the cabal. They believe that they are the 12 tribes of Israel, or the 13 holy bloodlines. They believe that. They believe that they have a birthright to rule over humankind as overlords. They believe that. This is all part of their Luciferian doctrine, and it has branched off. They've taken little pieces of the Hebrew Bible and stuff, and they've written their own, the Talmud and the doctrines of demons. And please don't get caught up in these other videos in the Truther movement who aren't differentiating, and they're just saying, oh, the Jews are doing it, the Jews are doing it. That's the same exact thing that the Nazis said in their propaganda. So you can see the infiltration in the truth movement. They've come in because people are hot on the trail of the truth and they're sniffing it out, and they've infiltrated and they're bringing people right back under the Nazi agenda. Please don't let that happen to you. We are the Hebrews. We are the descendants of Adam. Humans. Humans are the Hebrews. The Gentiles are the Nephilim offspring. We are not the Gentiles. I know we've been taught that by them, and they've infiltrated the organized religion, and oh, we're the Gentiles, that oh, we, I guess we'll be saved. I guess. No, we are the Hebrews. If you're a human, you're a Hebrew. You're a descendant of Adam. The Gentile races, it's really clear. It talks about them again and again, the Hittites, the Moabites. It talks about where they came from. These pagan bloodlines from these ancestral gods, which were the fallen angels, the Raphaim, the Nephilim. I mean, essentially, that's what the whole Bible is about. God trying to save his children, trying to stop the extinction of the human race. And the Bible records some bottlenecks in history, in world history, where the humans were almost extinct. Not just Noah, when the world got down to 8 humans. But it also talks about back in Abraham and Lot's time that he said the same thing. He was going to repopulate the earth from Abraham. And Abraham's relative, Lot, remember when they escaped from Sodom and Gomorrah before it was destroyed? Lot's daughters actually said that they had to mate with their father because there were no humans left. There are none like us, they said. They got their father drunk so that both of those daughters could conceive children. Go back and read those verses that seem to make no sense. They flat out said, the daughters said, they didn't want to do that. Who would want to do that? But they said, there's none left. There are no humans left. There's no one for us to have children with. Near extinction of the human race. Read the records of when Joseph's relatives came into Egypt to survive the famine. It said there were only 70 humans left. All of the Hebrews that were left combined were 70. It says the number in the Bible. And then it says when they went into Egypt, then they prospered and multiplied and built the human population up again to millions. And that's when the pharaohs are like, whoa, there's more of them than us. We need to stop this. Here's the verse right here. Then Pharaoh gave this order to all his people. Every Hebrew boy that is born, you must throw into the Nile. But let every girl live. And remember, that was the story of Moses. When he was a baby, they hid him away. They hid him away in that basket, and Pharaoh's daughter found him, and he was raised in Pharaoh's household. God set him up. He placed him inside that regime for a later time, for the deliverance of the human race from that slavery. But this is what we're seeing today, this assault on our boys, on our men, on the masculinity. They've effeminized our men. They've humiliated them. They've emasculated them. They're assailing them with everything. Chemicals, BPA, you know, look up BPA plastic. For decades, they put it inside all of our canned goods as a lining, still is in a lot. And, you know, all of our plastic dishes that we microwave, all of that affects the hormones of our boys. So they are under assault. Sperm counts are dropping as much as 52%. They're chemically castrating our men right in front of our faces. A strange thing has happened to men over the past few decades. We've become increasingly infertile, so much so that within a generation, we may lose the ability to reproduce entirely. What's causing this? Just Google it. There's a zillion articles on it. And everybody's just going on with their life while this assault on our men is almost complete. assault on humanity as a whole. And that's not counting the nanotechnology and the chemtrails. And they've destroyed the nuclear family unit. So the majority of boys are raised in fatherless homes, and they pick up the mannerisms of their mothers. They are effeminized. They're doing this on purpose. They're taking our warriors. They're taking our providers. They're taking our protectors. They're taking the heads of our household. They're doing this to humans on purpose. And they've always done it. This verse is from thousands and thousands of years ago. And they knew, get rid of the boys. That's how you destroy the human race. Get rid of the boys. They said, well, keep the girls because we can use them. And that was the breeding program. That was the hybridization program. If you go up into Exodus 1:19, it talks specifically about the way that the human women, you know, could produce babies. But the Egyptian women had a lot of trouble. Because we know hybrids are barren and sterile. It's like a mule, which is a mix between a horse and a donkey. So because it's a hybrid, it comes out sterile and not able to reproduce itself. These were fail-safes that were put in place in our DNA, and they're trying to circumvent them. That's what the whole Bible is about. So I don't really know how you can understand the Bible unless you read it in the context of what we see in the archaeological record, which is reality. That's why Moses had to teach the humans something as remedial as the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not kill. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't worship these Nephilim gods. Because these humans were born into the Egyptian culture. They had been living amongst demon spawn their whole life. They had to be taught the very basics of morality. And here we are again. Here we are again, under the rule of this cabal, being taught every sort of perversion and fallen angel worship and all of it. We're right back where we started from, enslaved to them again. So back to the Nazi twinning or cloning research. While we, the rest of us, are becoming increasingly infertile, as well as them encouraging our descendants to have abortions and do exactly what the Egyptian Pharaoh was doing to the Hebrew children and all of their other ways of population control, while they're doing that to us, they are multiplying their own descendants. The number of twins that you see come out of Hollywood is inordinate, to say the least. And these are just the ones they show us, not the crazy stories that we hear are going on in the underground bases from MyLab whistleblowers and that type of thing. This is just what they show us to our faces. So people are noticing, here's an article, what's with the twins explosion in Hollywood? Everyone assumes it's due to IVF. So of course, Beyonce and Jay-Z had twins. Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie had twins. Celine Dion, George Clooney and that had twins. And of course, we can't forget the face of the public royals, Kate Middleton, or now Prince William's wife, twins. Mila Kunis and Ashton Kutcher. Gwen Stefani. Ooh, it's a miracle baby at 46. You'll see that a lot too. Tons of celebrities having miracle babies at like 50 years old. Jennifer Lopez, twins. Julia Roberts, twins. Sarah Jessica Parker and Matthew Broderick, twins. Mariah Carey had twins. Brooke Shields had twins. Robert De Niro had twin sons through in vitro fertilization. Dennis Quaid had twins. Angela Bassett had twins. But you get the picture. While sperm counts are way down for the rest of us, the A-list elitists, they're like hatching them by the litter. And on top of that, they're adopting tons of children. You know, Nicole Kidman's adopted a bunch of kids. You know, Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt adopted several children. Hugh Jackman and this person here. Went through both IVF and ended up adopting children, two children they adopted. And don't get me wrong, of course, I think adopting children is amazing. Giving children a wonderful home. I myself would love to adopt children if I wasn't already a single mom. I would love that. I think it's a fantastic thing. That's not the issue. The issue is that so many of these people adopting these children then are transitioning them and transgendering them. Like here, you can go on here and see Charlize Theron, and she says she adopted this young black boy, and now she's making him dress like a girl and telling everybody she has two daughters now. You can go. Here's the interviews. Click on it. She talks about her two daughters, and there's tons of pictures of her dressing him up like a girl. She's transgendering him. She says that he identifies as a girl. So here this white woman adopts these young black children and starts humiliating this little black boy. Where are the Black Lives Matter people on this? In my opinion, this is child abuse. And we see it with tons of celebrities. Here's Pink, big shocker, right? I mean, she's so feminine. Pink is raising her daughter gender neutral. Daughter, just look at the picture. I'll leave it to you. Both of them. It's just so sad that they do this to their children and publicly. And again, I'm so tired of being gaslighted just for reporting what we see with our own eyes. When we say that they're transitioning their children and they're changing the gender of their children, they're doing it openly. It's like on the cover of magazines. This isn't some conspiracy theory. This was a little girl. This was one of her twins. And starting when she was just a toddler, they started dressing her like a boy and transitioning her into a boy in the public eye. And there's no doubt that that's child abuse. These children haven't even gone through puberty yet. They don't have their hormones. They don't know. They can't make decisions. I mean, in fact, we won't even let a human get a driver's license until they're 16. They can't make those kind of decisions. They can't even buy a beer till they're 21. We don't think they're responsible enough to make those type of decisions, but they're telling us that these children are capable of making decisions for the rest of their life at 3 years old, 5 years old, 7 years old. My son, between the ages of 4 and 6, he thought he was a robot. So I didn't go and start cutting body parts off and putting machine parts on him and be like, he identifies as a robot. I'm just being a good mom. No, they'd have locked me up. Because it's insanity, but yet these people are saying it's not insanity. Now my son pretends to be a dinosaur all the time. That's his thing. But I would never say, well, my son identifies as a dinosaur. That's who he's going to be for the rest of his life. And even when it just comes to sexuality, when I was in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, I thought boys had cooties. All little kids are like that. Thank God my parents didn't say, oh, well, look, she's gay. We're going to start transitioning her. I never would have had a life. I never would have had my son if they would have robbed me of my identity just because when I was 6, 7, 8 years old, I thought boys had cooties. So this goes beyond bad parenting. This is child abuse. They're robbing these children of their human rights. This is just so sad, and it's not the choice of the child, it's the choice of the parent. They've made this transgender thing so hipster, right? So trendy. You're like the cool celebrities, you're fitting in with all this transgender stuff. And so this little child's being toted around like a Gucci purse. She's like, look at my transgender child. Well, this is not a Gucci purse. This is a little boy, this is a human being. Have we lost all touch with reality? This is an emergency. This is 911. Do you know the suicide rates of transgenders are like 40 to 50%? Suicide attempts, and in some countries, successful suicide rates are above 40%.
For this reason alone, I would think psychiatrists would want to talk people out of transitioning. 46% of trans men and 42% of trans women attempted suicide. This is from the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, the Williams Institute. And in India, 31% of transgender people die from suicide.
Michelle Cretella is the president of the American College of Pediatricians. She just wrote a piece in which she says, we're quoting now, transgender ideology has infiltrated my field and produced large-scale child abuse. Gratella says doctors are encouraging parents to have their kids change genders when there's no evidence these changes are safe or even helpful. Dr. Gratella joins us now.
Thank you very much, Tucker. I'm glad to be here. I think it's important to say that everyone on both sides of this issue is concerned about finding loving and healthful solutions for all children.
Yes, I think that's right.
Yeah. Honestly, we at the American College of Pediatricians, and also I have many colleagues on the left, also insist that those solutions be rooted in reality, and transgender ideology is not. Sex is hardwired from before birth, and it cannot change. And that's why we've actually called this child abuse, because by feeding children and families these lies, children are having their normal psychological development interrupted. They're being put on the puberty blockers, which essentially castrates them chemically, followed by surgical mutilation later on. This is child abuse. It's not healthcare.
It's MK Ultra is what it is. It's MK Ultra for the masses. And I'm sure some people were probably shocked to hear a doctor say that sex is hardwired, because they've, you know, been brainwashed for so long by this cult. But she is speaking medically. That's the truth. They've blurred the lines of logic so much that they've confused gender with sexual attraction. And those are two completely different things. It shouldn't be confusing at all. It's really very simple. If you have same-sex attractions, that doesn't change your gender. People lust after lots of things. People desire lots of things. But that doesn't change anybody's gender. Peanut butter is not a gender. If you lust after money, you're not a dollar bill. It doesn't change your gender if you're a male or female. If you have same-sex attractions, that's sexual attraction. That doesn't change your, it doesn't change your X and Y chromosome. It does not change your biology. It does not change your genitalia. It does not change anything scientific, biological, or genetic about you. Sexual attraction is a completely different thing. There are pedophiles who are sexually attracted to little babies. That has nothing to do with gender. There are men and women who have same-sex attractions to adults. That has nothing to do with gender. But see, they've blurred it all. They've lumped it all into this LGBTQ, LMNOP type thing. And that's why it's so dangerous. Because then these pseudo-psychiatrists, instead of discouraging people from destructive behavior, are encouraging this self-mutilation and destructive behavior. And then these people follow the advice of the cult, and they end up transgendered and suicidal, because there was no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. They're still tormented souls, only now they're disillusioned and even more hopeless. And the official suicide rates reflect that. This is real. I'm not speaking from a religious perspective. I'm speaking from a scientific perspective. Those suicide rates are real. These people are being psychologically harmed by being encouraged into self-destructive behaviors. And as always, now the satanic cult has taken it to the next step through the legal process to make it illegal for counselors or psychiatrists or psychologists to even try to advise patients any other way than this self-destructive behavior. I did a video about it right here. Wake up, it's here, Antichrist law to ban the Bible in California. And they want to make it a crime to have any other perspective than their Luciferian androgynous cult beliefs. So they're saying that it's harmful. They call it conversion therapy, which breaks down to the Christian Bible. You can't tell them that homosexuality is wrong. You can't, you know, because that's so damaging to them, for anyone to influence them in any way other than further down the road of gender confusion and perversion and things like that. So it's California Assembly Bill 2943 that seeks to make it a crime and outlaw Christian counseling or any, like the clip of the doctor that I just said, and used to there, you can go and look up the articles. 60% of psychiatrists called it body dysmorphia disorder. They believed it was a mental illness when you can't identify with your own body. And, you know, there were cases of body dysmorphia disorder where people would want to cut off their own limbs and things like that. And clearly any licensed professional could not encourage that. Because that would be insanity, right? To allow a patient to cut their arm off because they had body dysmorphia disorder, but they can encourage them to cut their penis off or their breasts off or, you know, any other body parts. So it's the pinnacle of hypocrisy and it's just illogical. I can't believe it, but people, they're behind this. I mean, this is really a cult. This is happening. It's just happening on such a large scale, it's hard to imagine. So you can trace this as far back as you can go into theater. And then even before the invention of the television, at the theaters, the silent movies, you see it. And then as we move into the old black and white movies, and then into the invention of television and so forth, it's just increased and increased and increased. And the use of these actors continued all the way up to the present time. The problem is, like I always talk about in my videos, they didn't have to put our eyes out to blind us. They blinded us with our minds. So if you think you're looking at a woman, you just, you know, you don't think about it. It just is. It is what they tell you it is. It's like my whole video series about the biggest secret hidden in plain sight, that you can see petrified fossils right in front of your face or a giant tree stump right in front of your face. You can see all of these things, evidence of the real world all around us, but we just don't see it because they told us it wasn't so. And up until the Great Awakening, people just believed what they were told. And it's especially hard to believe that our sex symbols that men have lusted after for generations could be men. I mean, men especially aren't going to want to admit that Katharine Hepburn could be a man, that they might have been tricked into being attracted to a man, again, with the MK Ultra trauma-based mind control. It's traumatic for a God-fearing heterosexual man to admit that he might have been tricked into lusting after another man. But even if you can't admit that, say, Katharine Hepburn, for example, could have possibly been a cross-dressing male or transvestite or transgender, you have to admit that they did at least use her in transgender films. In the 1935 film Sylvia Scarlett, Katharine Hepburn plays a transvestite man. In the film, she cuts all of her hair off. She decides she's going to be a man and that it's a transgender movie. Look it up and watch it. I'm not making this up. And they introduced the first woman kissing woman lesbian act. This is still back in black and white movies when they were introducing this agenda. So it was long before we saw Madonna stick her tongue down Britney Spears' throat on stage at the Music Awards or Christina Aguilera and Madonna making out in their underwear at the Music Awards. They started on the parents and the parents' parents, decades and decades ago, a full generation or two ago, they started slowly normalizing this so that there wouldn't be an uproar when we got to this point where we are now, the externalization of the hierarchy. But even with this scene I'm about to show you right now, there was an uproar in 1935. People walked out of the theaters. It really harmed her career. They had to do some damage control to bring it back around.
I want to get it like Ronald Coleman.
No.
Hold still now. Wait a minute. I'll get there.
Marvelous.
I say, I wonder what it'd be like to kiss anybody with a mustache like that.
I don't know.
Let's try.
And it's no coincidence, like the Arquettes, that they all end up, I mean, this is the one that's openly transgender, but the entire family just happens to be actors. This story of the dreamy-eyed person who gets on a bus and goes out to LA to become famous, that's just a story. These people are all from the same family. This is generational. This is nepotism. I mean, yes, there are lots of people who are waiters and waitresses in Hollywood getting bit parts and stuff like that. But it's naive to think that you're going to make it to the A-list without an initiation. And as hard as it is to believe, many of our sex symbols, the ones that they have created for us to be sex goddesses, they are men. So I want to show you several examples. First, I want to go through the anatomy because there is actual anatomical differences between men and women that can help you see through the deception. And that's especially sinister. It's one thing to make decisions for yourself, but it's a complete different thing to deceive others. And these people have conspired together to deceive humanity. So let's go through a few of the ways that can help us identify the Decepticons. Now again, this is science. This is reality, not conspiracy theory. If forensic investigators find a body that all of the flesh and muscle, face, everything is gone, they can still identify whether it is a male or a female body because the bone structure is different. The pelvic region of the female has to be wider because a baby has to pass through there. See, a baby could never be born through this hip. And the bone structure coming down from the back actually goes all the way down in the male, and it's very short in the female. And you know, the tendons and the muscles are attached to this bone structure. So here's a typical example. I mean, these are incredibly fit humans, especially in this, you know, day and age of fast food and GMO food and all of this stuff. But the point is there are differences between a male and a female, no matter what kind of clothes you put on them. And this shows those examples with flesh over the bone structure. So a man will have this right here. It's called the Adonis belt. Okay, you see a woman, no matter how skinny she gets, the actual muscle structure and how the tendons attached to the bones are different. So a male will have this Adonis belt structure, and the navel will be above the indentation of the waist. But you can see, so there's the indentation of the waist, and the navel will be above the Adonis belt. And on a female, if they're extremely thin and fit, you know, then you can see it well, that the curve will go in right below the rib cage, and the navel will be below the waist. Navel below the waist, navel above the Adonis belt. Another would be the Adam's apple. Males have an Adam's apple and females do not. So that's usually a dead giveaway. Back when I was coming up, it was so rare, but when I lived out in California and you'd go over to the west side, you'd know who the tranny hookers were because they had Adam's apples. So, you know, the elitists, they have lots of plastic surgery and stuff like that. So you don't see it all that often. For example, here are a couple of pictures from plastic surgeons' websites for advertisements about this transgender surgeries that they do. And you can see here, the Adam's apple here, they shave it down. They actually go in and shave it down. Now, that does grow back. The cartilage and everything does grow back. So you will see that in the celebrities over the years in between surgeries. And here's another one that just shows the extent they will go to. They literally grind down their bones and shave down, sand down the bones underneath the skin because the brow ridge in a male is very pronounced and a female is more flat, like the sloping. And you can see here where that's been taken down. They've taken it down to feminize the face. They also round off these jaw bones because men have very angular jaw bones. And women have more of a sloping, rounded style jawbone, typically speaking. And men, as they age, you know, really fill in. If you look at a young boy, they have a very skinny face. And as they turn into a man, and then through middle age and an older man, you'll see their faces really square out. They continue to fill out. So yeah, one of the plastic surgery things is to go in, actually shave down that jaw to feminize the face. And again, if you pay close attention to how a lot of these stars age, you will see that filling in, squaring of the jaw as they get older. So you won't see it 100% of the time, but in the regular population out in the bars and the clubs in California, you did see it. So this would be an example. Like, this looks like a female, right? But the Adam's apple is a dead giveaway. And once the veil's removed from your eyes and you know what you're looking at, you'll see the Adam's apples. You'll see it. You can absolutely see it if you pay attention. Especially if you go all the way back to some of their younger work before they were A-list, and you'll be able to see, like right here, it's pretty pronounced. You can see it there. It's less pronounced. You can, especially when they're laughing and stuff, is usually when you can catch it like that. You can see it's clear. And again, with the male Adonis belt, the love handle, the Adonis belt structure. And you can see she's conscious of it, covering it. And make note of that when you see these types of impromptu pictures, because in all of their studio pictures, to make their bodies whatever they want them to look like. But when they're out in public, you'll notice they do this a lot. It's always hands on the hip, bending to one side so you can't see the boyish straight figure. All of that type of thing, this type of thing, covering the Adonis belt. Now, I'm not going to do a whole bunch of transvestigations in this video. There are tons of people doing that. Just type in transvestigation or transpocalypse now or something like that, and they go person by person. Some of the channels do a great job, others of them don't. So you'll just have to wade through it and look at the evidence. Like, you can look at Cameron Diaz here and you can see the Adonis belt. And you can see, again, it's that same old thing that you catch them doing when they're not there in the comfort of their studios with all of the airbrushing and professional photographers and photoshopping. If they get caught vacationing in the oceans around the world or whatever, then you'll see them do this if there's a camera around. They know what they're hiding. They know what they're covering up. So, I mean, you'll have to make up your own mind. But when I see the straight up and down and the Adonis belt of the people they're parading in front of us, even with all of the shots that their parents gave them growing up and all of that, you still can't get rid of bone structure. And I know it's hard to believe. I mean, who wants to believe this? But all the makeup in the world doesn't change the fact that there is this structure, this solid sheet of muscle that goes all the way down to the groin. This Adonis belt. There's pink in a bikini. I mean, it's crystal clear. And Britney Spears is another one who has a really, really visible Adonis belt. If you know what you're looking for, go back now and watch her different dance routines and stuff when they don't have it camouflaged by higher waisted stuff. And then she has the low riders on and things like that. It's really, really apparent. I mean, look at that. If you just covered it up, it wasn't in a bikini, would you really think that's a female torso? Okay, that's enough of that. You get the point. You can go further with that if you want. I want to jump back to the breeding program because they're enhancing these embryos in a lot of different ways besides transgendering. There are programs creating super soldiers and interspecies hybrids and all types of things. Now, a lot of that is done in the underground bases and it's not out in the open, like the twinning with the celebrities. But many, many of the celebrities have publicly stated that they have embryos, frozen embryos still that they're not using. Think about that. These are already embryos. Not sperms and eggs. These are babies. These are embryos, fertilized embryos, frozen, just in case they want to unfreeze them and create another human. Like, here's an example where frozen embryos were used by the grandparents because both of the parents were killed in a car crash, but they had frozen babies in storage and the grandparents fought, and the baby, these dead people's baby, was born 4 years after they died. And here's a case of baby Emma being born after 24 years. In November of 2017, a baby was successfully born from an embryo frozen for 24 years, the longest period a viable embryo has ever been stored. Baby Emma is just one example of the amazing fertility solutions science has developed in just a few short years. I mean, that at least has to make you think Could there be anything besides plant seeds being stored in the New World Order Arctic storage unit? I mean, they're open about it being the global seed vault and that they have stored all of these seeds for some sort of doomsday event. But, you know, when we're talking about embryos also being frozen for decades and decades, I don't know, it at least has to make you question, could there be anything else being stored in this giant freezer in the Arctic? There's no doubt that all of this trans agenda and the trans movement has a lot of bleed over in the fields. They seem to keep it all in the family. And now Brad Pitt is seeing, or at least was seeing, this MIT professor who is leading the transhumanism movement. So this goes well beyond transgender. This is transhumanism as well. And Neri Oxman just happens to be the figurehead from MIT who is leading the movement creating synthetics, not just clones straight from another human cell, another human embryo. No, synthetics created biologically through other means. So although not a ton of these videos are showing the science behind their claims of clones, robotoids, and non-human entities, organic robotoids, things like that, there is science behind it. And it, when they say robotoids, she speaks openly in her TED talk I'm about to play you about melding, about joining mechanics, machines, with these organic synthetics that she and her team of scientists are creating. Here, listen to her in her own words.
The split personality of every designer and architect operating today between the chisel and the gene, between machine and organism, between assembly and growth, between Henry Ford and Charles Darwin. My work at its simplest level is about uniting these two worldviews. As designers, we must today bring into account not only the digital, but also the biological. So from nature-inspired design to a design-inspired nature. We live in a very special time in history, a rare time. A time when the confluence of four fields is giving designers access to tools we've never had access to before. These fields are computational design, allowing us to design complex forms with simple code. Additive manufacturing, letting us produce parts by adding material rather than carving it out. Materials engineering, which lets us design behavior of materials in high resolution. And synthetic biology, enabling us to design new biological functionality by editing DNA. In our next project, we explore the possibility of creating a cape and skirt like a second skin that are made of a single part. Together with my long-term 3D printing collaborator, Stratasys, we 3D printed this cape and skirt with no seams between the cells. The designers have access to such high-resolution analytic and synthetic tools, enables us to design products that fit not only the shape of our bodies, but also the physiological makeup of our tissues. But is nature ideal? What would design be like if objects were made of a single part? Would we return to a better stage of creation? So we looked for that biblical material, that fruit-bearing, fruit-tree kind of material, and we found it. Together with our collaborators at Harvard and MIT, we embedded bacteria that were genetically engineered to rapidly capture carbon from the atmosphere and convert it into sugar. For the first time, we were able to generate structures that would seamlessly transition from beam to mesh, and if scaled even larger, to windows. To do that, we needed to contain bacteria and be able to control their flow. So like the periodic table, we came up with our own table of the elements. New life forms that were computationally grown, additively manufactured, and biologically augmented. In our first piece of clothing, we combined two microorganisms. Now, these two microorganisms never interact in nature. In fact, they never met each other. They've been here engineered for the first time to have a relationship inside a piece of clothing. Think of it as evolution, not by natural selection, but evolution by design. We then started growing these channels on the human body.
So I can't think of anything more fun than wearing fake skin made out of living cells of E. coli. Hey, but that does bring to remembrance a lot of the reports of the whistleblowers talking about these quote-unquote gray aliens, that they are essentially worker drones, that they are synthetics. And people always report them as, well, they're wearing these suits, these clothes, but it was more like skin. And they'll say things like, but you can't touch them because they'll make you sick. And a lot of that seems to make sense now that we understand that they're bioengineering these synthetics using bacteria and combining bacteria like E. coli with other bacteria that it's never been joined with in natural circumstances. Doesn't that harken back to the disclosure that she's talking about right here, that they are admitting that they are making clothing, which is essentially synthetic skin, out of living cells? And not just skin, other organs too. In other presentations, she goes around on the circuit presenting this technology. She talks about creating organs.
In this particular case, this system is inspired by the gastrointestinal tract to design a kind of artificial digestive system for the human body.
So synthetics, clones, breeding programs, this all seems like too hard to believe. But it's true. They've been doing this for generations. Surely we haven't already forgotten about the Nazi Lebensborn program, where they were openly breeding children. So if we're wondering what all this is about, there, this is what it's about. They were creating a master race, a ruling class. And to do that, they needed to populate the world with their offspring. So it shouldn't be shocking that we see these programs continue. And we see the master race, the ruling class, doing the same thing today, openly and hidden. And again, if you read their records and their writings in their own words, in all of the different tentacles of the beast, you can see that it all goes together. Like here, okay, the Lebensborn program. Lebensborn means fountain of life. And they say they're trying to create this master race, which will be the man of the future and will rule the world. And we even call them the ruling class. That's what's weird. It's like we know it, but we're blinded to it at the same time. It's bizarre. I mean, that's mind control. And we all know about the Nazi UFO connection, but let's read on and take that on down the line so we can make sense of what we're seeing around us. The most promising future mothers of rulers of the world have been recognized: Scandinavian and Norwegians, the descendants of the old Vikings. They approximate the Aryan and therefore can donate to the Fuhrer kids. And that's exactly what we see in one race of the Nephilim, which now we call the aliens. People in the UFO communities and all of that talk about them openly. They're called the Nordics, the Tall Whites, sometimes the Pleiadians, whatever their new disguise is or their trick is this time. They're the same exact Nephilim who have been trying to trick humanity through the Nazi regime, through the UFO community. The New Agers are channeling these demons saying, oh, you know, these are Ashtar Command. These are light workers. And they're teaching them things like walk-ins. Now the New Age movement has this thing, oh, I'm a walk-in, which means that some other soul took over your body at some point. Is that not the very definition of demon possession? It's unbelievable that people just yield themselves to these Nephilim, to these demons. So why the breeding program? What do they want? They want bodies. They need bodies. Like I talked about earlier, hybrids can't reproduce, or they have a lot of trouble reproducing, like the mule. You know, it's a hybrid between a horse and a donkey. You have a mule, but the mule can't reproduce. It's usually infertile. These entities, these hybrids, Nephilim hybrids, they can't reproduce the way humans can. They are small remnants of these lost civilizations. So they have like a zillion different types of breeding programs, synthetics, clones, just regular straight human breeding programs, the way we breed cattle as livestock. We are livestock to them. That's why we've seen in a lot of the leaked documents, Illuminati leaked documents and government documents in these programs, they call us cattle because that's what we are to them. And like I've mentioned before, a lot of times in my videos, that verse in Genesis 6, where it says that they took human women because they were beautiful, that's not how that translates. The actual translation of that word doesn't say beautiful at all. It says they took human women because they were a fit extension. A fit extension. If you want more research on that, go to Tom Horn. Tom Horn has gone into depth with that. He's over at Skywatch TV. Anyway, that's the exact truth. They need bodies to interact with our five dimensions. Our five senses perceive five dimensions, five different frequency ranges. So for them to reign on Earth, for them to have influence in our world and in our overlaid set of five dimensions, they need to do that through bodies, through humans. That's how they reign on Earth. If we are the portals. Bodies are the portals. If we resisted them and did not allow them to reign in our lives, in our bodies, in our minds, they would be invisible to us. They would not have any influence in our world, which is exactly the antithesis, the Antichrist, the antithesis of Jesus Christ reigning on earth. We are the body of Christ. We are the portals. When we surrender our lives to Jesus Christ and we invite the Holy Spirit to possess us and live through us, we become the literal body of Christ. And thereby, Christ reigns in the earth. Christ has influence in this world, the salt and the light. We influence the world with our light, with the life of Jesus Christ that lives in us and through us. Right here, Romans 12, 1, offer your bodies a living sacrifice, a living sacrifice. That's what we do. That's what all that stuff means about die to self, right? Die to self and give your life over to the service of Jesus Christ so that we can see beauty in this world again, holiness, morality, peace instead of war, all of these things if we yield to Jesus Christ. Well, it's the same for them. They need bodies to yield to, well, it's the same to them. They need bodies to yield to these disembodied evil spirits. It's the armies of Antichrist. It's really very simple. And that's why they teach all of this perversion and even transhumanism. It's a sort of artificial reincarnation. They want to incarnate in these bodies. And they need people who will not resist that. We are the resistance. And they need bodies who won't resist that. Because demons are evil, right? They want to come and do all of this perversion. That's what they want. They're demons. Look at the stories coming from the SRA victims. Coming from the whistleblowers of MK Ultra and the SRA families and the cabal families. Listen to the stories about the snuff films. Like the Son of Sam serial killer said he was making for elitists. Listen to what the MyLabs say go on in the underground bases. And not the scientific stuff. Stuff like Donald Marshall and the others say that they saw just the enjoyment of the most horrific things we could ever imagine as humans. Humans who don't take part in the underworld. The stories that come out of there, the torturous things and the hunting of people and the, you know, just torture and bloodletting and everything. Torturous, unimaginable evil. That's because they have created this ruling class, this master race, this cabal who does not resist those impulses. And that's what they're doing to our human children with this identity crisis. Don't resist if you have this urge, you're compelled, you have an attraction or a compulsion, something compels you to do something perverse, embrace that. That's your identity. Don't resist it, which is the exact opposite of what the Bible teaches us. The Bible tells us take every thought captive. If you feel compelled, if you feel an impulse, you test that thought by the Word of God, by the Holy Spirit, because all thought energy is not from us. Our brains are also like radio receivers. We receive information. We not only broadcast and manifest thought, we receive thoughts. But they don't want us to know that. They don't want us to know that thoughts may not be our own. They want us to think that's us, that that's us, that those evil thoughts are coming from us. And that's just not always the case. The Bible is clear. Take every thought captive and test it, because evil spirits influence the brains of mankind. The Bible even says causing electrical disturbances like epilepsy. Right here in 2 Corinthians, we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. That's what we're doing here today, right now. 1 John 4:1, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. But they don't want us to know that. They don't want us to even know how our human brains work, because they don't want us to know who we are. That's how they keep us slaves. That's why they ban the Bible. Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed from lack of knowledge because you have rejected knowledge. Right here in James 4:7, submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. All you have to do is resist. They don't have any authority over us. We're the children of God. We have to willingly give our will to them. They don't have any authority if we resist. Right here, Luke 10:20. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. The spirits have to submit to us. We are the ones in charge. The demons know that. Jesus just went around casting them out. Get out, go. He didn't fuss with them. He didn't do all this big screaming, yelling match. He's just go. Because we have authority. But they don't want us to know that. They don't want us to know who we are. They don't want us to know where we are. Everything that they've told us about our reality is a lie. Because they want us to think we are subservient to them. When in fact, the spiritual realm is subservient to us, the children of the Most High God, the Hebrews, the humans. That's why they're indoctrinating us into all this perversion, because they can't have this sort of SRA cabal lifestyle unless humans willingly give their lives a living sacrifice to these demons and let them indwell them and do not resist. That's what all this spirit cooking garbage is about. These effigies, they make these effigies of their own bodies, right? And then they take cakes, make like a body out of cake that looks like them. And then they take a knife to it. This is a party to them. This is the cabal. They're showing that they're sacrificing their body, right? They take a knife to it. They're going to kill it and devour it. It's just a representation of what they know they are. A living sacrifice. Like the Bible says, die to self, right? And yield your body to the Spirit. We yield to the Holy Spirit because we love holiness and beauty and peace. But they yield their bodies to a different spirit. And that's what this all represents. And again, with the predictive programming, does anybody remember the movie called The Boys from Brazil? It's from 1978. It was Gregory Peck and Laurence Olivier. So a lot of you younger people who aren't as old as me, this was before your time, but you should go back and watch it because it tells the whole story, basically, hidden in plain sight. Of course, they say it was science fiction, but here's the crux of what they're talking about. Lieberman gains insight from Maloney, an incarcerated former Nazi guard who worked with the adoption agency, before realizing during a meeting with a professor, an expert on cloning, the terrible truth behind the Nazi plan. Mengele, in the 1960s, had secluded several surrogate mothers in a Brazilian clinic and implanted them with zygotes, each carrying a sample of Adolf Hitler's DNA preserved since World War II. 94 clones of Hitler had then been born and sent to different parts of the world for adoption. Mengele had arranged for all of them to be placed with foster parents, similar to Hitler's own, because we know Hitler himself was a creation. He was a biological son of the Vienna Rothschilds, but he was raised in a different household. The same way that Bill Clinton is William Jefferson Blythe, but, you know, he was raised as a Clinton. It just goes on and on. There's so much I would love. to talk about, but again, it'd be a 200-hour video. Let's get going. But the point is that, yeah, this is what it's all about. It's talking about the breeding program then, that it continued in South America. And essentially, there's a battle going on between white hats and these men in black, the men in black being the continued underground shadow government, Nazi regime type thing, the Ashkenazi. But anyway, in the movie, Mengele goes on to order the assassination of these 94 different clones, or these 94 different genetically engineered spawn in 9 different countries. But suffice it to say, there is a huge grain of truth in all of these predictive programming propaganda pieces. Sound familiar? Those of you who follow my channel know that I've done several videos over the years laying the foundation, laying the groundwork for the concepts that I'm leading up to talking about. But we have to go through some of this stuff and lay the foundations. Otherwise, there's a large percentage of people who just won't be able to receive the things that I'm going to be talking about on my channel, because it's just, the communication gap is just too big. But I'm working up to something. And as I mentioned earlier, this doppelganger phenomenon was recorded in world history predating what we know as the World War II Third Reich generation of this Nazi movement. So in my opinion, there is no doubt that it's the Nephilim. The Nephilim have been doing this the whole time, because alien abductees report exactly that, that they see soul harvesting. Or they'll draw out and describe actual technological devices that store, like somehow digitally or something, store these consciousness entities, and that they are taken out and put into bodies and things like that. Here's just one little clip that I had played in my last transhumanism video. It's called Immortality or Extinction, Transhumanism, Artificial Intelligence, that kind of thing. Again, I encourage you to go back and watch that, because it's a stepping stone to the stuff that I'm talking about right now. But here's at least that clip. It involved the reptilians, mantis-like creatures, and these sort of robotoid gray alien types. And this is what she says happened.
I'm Intelligence Gray, who walks over to a bed-like apparatus upon which there is lying a male human. And the gray reaches down, and she even, the Linda, even asked me, could this be possible? Are they doing this in front of me like a hologram? Because this is what occurs. The gray's long four fingers just seem to pass through the man's chest. Shows it to Linda Porter, and she gets telepathic thoughts. Like this. It is important that the entity, and she gets the symbol or gets communication that when they say entity, they are meaning soul, spirit, the animus of life. That the man's entity and this particular container of the man's body, it's important that the soul remain inside of such a container for a longer period of time than the man's body is willing to give, because the man is dying of heart disease. But over in a tube, and when there's a gesture, now she sees that there are these tubes that have various people in them. And one she recognizes in the tube, which has light above and light below, is a man who looks a little bit younger than the man on the table. And the gray being communicates telepathically to her, because it is important for the soul spirit, but he uses the word entity, to stay inside of this type of container, we are going to revivify him in this cloned body, in this tube that we can preserve and control. And we are going to put him in Australia, and in his home in the United States, he will die.
Okay, I'm going to close out with this, but this will tie together a whole bunch of seemingly unrelated topics. Most of the eyewitnesses, the people who have had encounters with these different alien races, report that they're very much like AI, like artificial intelligence, in the sense that they're sociopaths, they're psychopaths. They don't seem to express emotion or have emotion or make decisions based on emotion. They're very task-oriented. And I have a series of 5 or 6, 7 maybe videos on artificial intelligence already involving the D-Wave quantum computer, which they say in their own words, and I put the clips there in the videos of them giving the seminars in their own words, they say that this quantum computer is reaching into other dimensions, quantum dimensions, and bringing back information and answers from another dimension. It's essentially a high-tech Ouija board, or like a ghost box, you know, that those ghost hunters use. This scans the frequency ranges if you leave it on white noise and that type of thing. Well, it's quite a bit more complex than that, but you get my point, that we are at that point technologically. I mean, this is what they're telling us out in the open, that they have this D-Wave quantum computer. And I want you to make note of the name D-Wave. This is no coincidence that they named this thing D-Wave, because obviously, although they don't say it, it's named after delta waves, delta brain waves, which are in a specific frequency range of deep sleep. It's like almost our deepest sleep, right before REM, which I'll talk about in just a second. Delta sleep is our deepest sleep, the point when our brain waves are least like waking. Interestingly, delta sleep is when sleepwalking and sleep talking is most likely to occur. So sleepwalking is just exactly what it sounds like. When you're asleep and you're not using your body and something else is, you're blacked out, you have no memory of it. It's exactly what people experience in possession. Anyway, I go way more into this dream state and sleep state because, like everything else, they've completely lied to us about what sleep state is and what the dream state is. That's why, you know, on my channel, I do all these dreams and visions, prophetic dreams and visions, because when you go places and see things and receive information and prophetic glimpses and all of that in the dream state, that's very real. But again, I can't go into that right now. That's for another video. But anyway, this video, Delta Brainwaves and the D-Wave Quantum Computer, the Dream State, Deja Vu and Spiritual Dimensions, that video at least lays the foundation for things I'll be talking about in the future. Before the purposes of this video, I just want to make the connection that they absolutely know about the dream states, and that's why the D-Wave quantum computer, interdimensional quantum computer, is named after the delta wave brain frequency. This also ties into the Montauk Project. Now, the devil's in the details, pun intended, because if you listen to the testimony of Preston Nichols and Duncan Cameron and Al Balick, not the big stuff, but some of the smaller details, you'll see all of these connections. I'll play a few seconds of an older interview from them. And in this part, Preston was talking about building a Delta T antenna. And while he was trying to replicate this antenna that was used in the Montauk Project, he experienced what he called time waves, and he lost consciousness. But again, all the way back before the Philadelphia experiment, in the early era of the Montauk Project groups, they already knew about delta waves because the antenna was called the Delta T.
Well, I started to work with a time transducer myself and had time currents flowing through me.
Mm-hmm.
Once I had the time currents flowing through me, I passed out up on the roof. When I came back, all of a sudden I started to remember everything.
Mm-hmm.
Up on the roof of this building is an antenna, very similar, a small edition of what they built out at Montauk for the main time antenna. We call the Delta T antenna.
Mm-hmm.
And mathematically, you can do wild things if you drive all three loops correctly. You can actually create time vortexes, time distortions and such if you know how to do it. Mm-hmm. You also have to have a electric field antenna above the Delta T.
Now, here's another astounding connection in the details of the Montauk Project. if you know the story and you've listened to all of their eyewitness testimonies over the years, then you probably already know. This is going to be a clip of Duncan Cameron. And he is talking about being soul transplanted. And this didn't seem to be related to anything, but that's precisely why I'm making this video so long and putting it all together in one place. Okay, so he claims that he and Al Bielek from the Philadelphia experiment were actually brothers, although at the time of these interviews, they were two totally unrelated people, and that they were born into a German family in the early 1900s, pre-World War II, actually circa World War I, and that they were born into a family that put them in these experiments, the soul transfer and Delta Wave experiments. But for the sake of this video, I just want to point out that, again, this is about a Montauk project in the United States of America, and yet this person is saying they are actually a German from the early 1900s that was soul transplanted into this body, Duncan Cameron.
I was volunteered by my father. That's a different story having to do with actually transplanting the soul into a different body, per se, without going through the typical incarnate process that in metaphysics, that's a standard phenomenon occurs.
So you're not in the same vessel you were born in?
That's correct.
Okay.
The original vessel is 1917 in Germany. Al was born in 1918. Yeah, we were volunteered.
Was your father in the service?
He was in the Navy for a number of years. Was in and out of the Navy and Coast Guard. He's another kind of interesting story in the sense that he was connected almost worldwide for reasons not really known, other than that he grew up in money. And there was money in the family to do sort of as he pleased.
Decades and decades later, Max Spears is another one of these super soldier whistleblowers who came out exposing these occult practices. You can take it or leave it. I don't know any of these people personally. You're not going to hurt my feelings if you don't, you know, if you don't believe it. Now, Max Spears was assassinated after he came out, so you might take that into account. And he talks about this soul transfer and Nazi involvement across a wide spectrum of events. He talks about them doing research in the camps on the B bloodline, not just the Rhesus negative, but on the B bloodline specifically, because he says there's some component in that bloodline that contributes to the hive mind. So he talked about using those people to overlay or transplant these souls of these grays who function as a hive unit. He also talked about being able to use groups, large groups of B bloodline people or AB bloodline people as sort of armies for the cabal unwittingly, that they could be used for gang stalking and different things like that because they're part of a hive mind that they may not be aware of on a conscious level. He also talked about soul transplants in just a natural metaphysical level, that there were times that he was lured to places and, say, offered drinks and things like that, where he was drugged and they did rituals on him where they let these entities enter him. And some of the ones he described were these ancient mythological creatures. Here's a clip where he talks about them trying to use him as a portal to bring this Minotaur spirit through, and that he did. He had inordinate strength, like 10 times his normal strength, and all of that, but the entity left him. Then directly after that clip, I will play the clip where he talks about going into dream state, again with the delta frequency and the REM dream state. And he says in that altered state of consciousness that two Nazi officers came to him.
Will you lift things up?
Yes. Yes, right. I felt like that's my important. Strength has increased by 5-10 times. Every time I took a bite out of it, it tasted like burning metal. So I spat it out and put it on the ground. He said to me, you're tasting that because the thing that has been placed inside of you has been biting on these chains for thousands and thousands of years, and now you have taken on that inside of you, so everything is going to taste like that. But not to worry, it's only going to last 3 days, and it'll be gone, and you'll feel fine again. After that, something happened, and my body went rigid, and whatever was inside of me was rejected and left. And then I felt it walked out. I mean, it left me, and I felt somebody who's related to me over and showed me this picture, and then they said, if it doesn't stick in you, it will certainly stick in him. And so then I got this terrible fear that
I'm going to kill you.
Yes. I went back into the other room and crashed out and fell asleep again. When I fell asleep again, there was two officers, not what seemed like Nazi officers, standing either side of me.
And what uniforms did they have?
They had the old World War II uniforms, from what I can understand. The stereotypical Nazi World War II uniforms, and they were standing either side of me. And they had told me that what's going on right now is that there have been 100-year war battles for the last 1,000 years.
Then even more recently, enter Donald Marshall, which I have to admit, when I first watched his interviews, or they weren't interviews, they were just tapings, I was like, okay, it's the ravings of a lunatic. I mean, he was just, there were cloning centers that he was taken to during REM sleep, and there was this vril reptilian creature sweating the quill, and you know, it was like, well, okay, all right, and click off. So I get it, but I want to take a second look at this with fresh eyes, because it has all of the same earmarks that we've seen throughout all of world history. First, the vril. He talks about the secret of vril, and he wasn't talking about it in the context of Nazis at all. So there's another connection. We know that the Nazis, their occult backing was the Thule Society and the Vril Society. The same thing. They had these channelers that channeled these aliens, per se. And they said this vril energy, this sort of free cosmic energy that could power everything and was actually a life force. But what Donald Marshall was talking about was this secret of vril, which were these reptilians in these underground bases, a sort of chupacabra looking gargoyle thing that would do this biological transplant called sweating the quill. It would essentially do a biochemical reaction where it would release spinal cord fluid into the brains of humans, which possessed them, made them drones. It was called droning. He described a very physical process where these world leaders and elitists were brought into these underground bases or these cloning centers. And he said this parasite would be forced into their eye. And he says sometimes it would cause damage even. But once it was in there, it would release this like spinal fluid that chemically altered their brain. And he said they became drones. From that point on, it was the parasite was controlling them, which is odd because he said that long before this phenomenon was noticed among people, long before QAnon or any of that. And another thing he said, which seemed so weird and out of place, but not out of place in this video, is he said that one thing that happened to the people after they were droned, which he didn't understand, he said they immediately all became bisexual and most of them pedophiles. So something to do with these demonic entities, with this form of symbiotic parasitical possession, it came with, he said 100% of the time, he said they would instantly become bisexual. You know, that's an odd thing to say in the scheme of the talk he was giving, because he wasn't talking about the trans agenda or anything like we're talking about. So to me, that's an important thing to recognize, that one of the traits of these entities is that they came with sexual perversion. Okay, and the very last thing that I wanted to point out about Donald Marshall that confirms all of this other stuff we've been hearing for generations is that he said that he was taken to these cloning centers when he entered REM sleep. And again, that was something that sounded so far out of the blue. That wasn't anything we had heard before. REM sleep, what on earth could REM sleep have to do with clones? What would REM sleep have to do with anything? Like, if you're going to make something up, why on earth would you make that up? But now we can see That, yeah, if you were going to make something up, you probably wouldn't make that up. But we're seeing that that's true, that all of their experiments have to do with the delta waves and the frequency ranges and the sleep frequencies. So to me, that brings some authenticity to Donald Marshall's story. So what do we do? That's the main question I get on all of my videos. It doesn't matter if it's a sun simulator video or if it's about the Nephilim races, the cryptids that we see, or if it's about this artificial intelligence and the neural implant mark of the beast and the technological reincarnation aspect where they want to link into our neurological circuits. It doesn't matter what kind of video it is. I always get the question, what do we do? And my answer is exactly what the Bible says. This is Jeremiah from the Old Testament. This is what God said to do the last time the Nephilim were reigning on earth. And this is from Revelation 18, which is about the end times, a prophetic verse about what to do in the end times. And the answer is, come out of her, my people. Run for your lives. Come out of Babylon, this Babylonian system, this beast system. Do not be partakers of it. Get saved. Get saved. Get saved. Jeremiah 51, 45. Come out of her, my people. Run for your lives. Run from the anger of the Lord because judgment is coming. And this judgment is not prepared for humans, it is for the devil and the fallen angels. Matthew 25, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. The Bible's clear repeatedly, this is not for humans. These humans, but he says, these are people here on the left. Matthew 25, starting here at 34, it says clearly there is a separation taking place. That's what we're seeing. People say, oh, I've never seen us so divided. They've just divided us, divided us. Yes, God is dividing us, the right from the left. He says he will put his sheep on his right, he'll put the goats on his left. The right will enter into everlasting life, and those on his left will enter into eternal damnation with their gods, the fallen angels. That's what the Bible says. So all of you people out there, I get this a lot too. They say, why do you always say leftist? You're so political. No, I'm not talking politically. I'm talking biblically. God says those separated onto his left. He says it again and again. He says Jesus Christ is seated at his right hand. Verse 34, then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Then you go down, you keep going. Verse 41, then he will also say to those on his left, depart from me, accursed ones, into the eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. But I'm not talking politically. I'm talking like bipolar, the separation of energy into the positive pole and the negative pole, into the movement of Christ, into the movement of Antichrist, at the right hand of God and at the left wing. That's what he says. So when I say leftist, don't take it politically. I mean leftist, people who are separated onto the left, who will enter into eternal punishment. And what do we do? Revelation 18:4. Then I heard another voice from heaven say, come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins and so that you will not receive of her punishments. The same way it was in the old world. Joshua 24:15. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites, the fallen ones in whose land you are living, or the Lord our God, the God of humankind. Choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And I beg you to do the same. Do not share in her sins. Do not partake of this culture that they have put on top of us and broadcast to us and created for us. If you've been caught up in all this transformation, come out of her. Do not let yourself be formed into the image of these fallen gods. Choose this day whom you will serve. serve the Most High God, holiness and beauty and cleanliness. Come out of the filthy world of the elitist ruling class cabal. Don't partake of their sins, and you won't partake of their judgment. I hope that something in this video shocked you enough to make you realize that when the Bible says, just as in the days of Noah, so will it be at the coming of the Son of Man, that's why the earth was cleansed in Noah's day, because what these Nephilim had done, they had corrupted everything. The thoughts of mankind was evil continually. The gene pool was corrupted. There were monsters on the earth. That's why the earth had to be cleansed. And it's the same at the coming of the Son of Man, which is what we've seen again. And not just with the human race and with the human gene pool and breeding programs. They've genetically modified everything. The plant kingdom, the animal kingdom, insects, they've genetically modified everything and mixed everything and made a mess of things. They've destroyed our environment. They've destroyed our gene pools. They've destroyed everything. They've captured the souls of our children. This is exactly the parable of the weeds, the parable of the tares and the wheat, the parable of the weeds and the harvest. And it explains exactly what it is. The field is the world. The good seed represents the sons of the kingdom of heaven. And the weeds are the sons of the evil one. And the harvest is the end of the age. The weeds will be collected to be burned in the fire. And God's people will be collected into his barn. That's the story of Noah. God will protect his people. There is an ark. We have a Lord. We have an oversoul called Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. He's the Messiah of all of humanity, because all of humanity are the Hebrews. We are one race, the human race, with one Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. He's our Lord. If you're a human and you're watching this, he's your Lord. Please don't reject so great a salvation. Because if you want to know what to do, that's the only thing to do. You're not going to make it out of this alive without him. He is our only hope. He is the only way. He is the only truth. John 14:6, Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Just as surely as we are the portal for the Holy Spirit into this world, Jesus Christ is the portal to the Holy Father. There is only one way, only one path, only one wavelength that can and will save us. And thank God he has goodwill toward men. So I know this has been a really long video, but in reality, there's so much more that needs to be said. But if I was forced to sum it up in just a few words, I guess what I'm trying to say is get your house in order. It is time to get your soul right. Jesus Christ is coming.